Cincinnati. Welcome to the Fox College Hoops pregame presented by Ford. Go further inside the Cintas Center. Sold out again for this Big East matchup. Providence off to its best start in conference play in more than a decade. Ready to take on Xavier. About a month left in the regular season. Providence and Butler both nipping at Villanova's heels at the top of the Big East standings. And with that, we say welcome courtside. Joe Davis along with Nick Klaw. This is a Xavier team that suffered a tough loss on Wednesday in overtime against Creighton. And now they've got a Providence team coming in that beat Georgetown this week. And they feature the top scoring duo in the conference.
Well, it's a gut check game for Xavier. And I expect a great effort from the Musketeers. And they're going to need a great effort in trying to slow down Dunn and Henton. Henton leads the Big East Conference in scoring. But behind every great scorer, there's a great passer. And that's Chris Dunn, who just spoon feeds Henton easy baskets in transition and in the half court that gets Henton's motor rolling. But make no mistake about it, Chris Dunn's the key to this game. Xavier's ball screen defense has to be on point in slowing down Chris Dunn.
We're trying to slow down those two guys along with these other three players in the starting five for Ed Cooley, Junior LaMamba, with Ben Bentzel and Carson DeRozers rounding out the starting five for the Friars. That's Providence. Here's Xavier. Davis, Nabel, and Davis in the backcourt. James Farr joins their leading scorer, Matt Stainbrook and Chris Max frontcourt. The rematch of an overtime game from 2 weeks ago in Rhode Island, a three-point Providence win. James Farr to jump it up against Carson DeRozers. And off we go from Cincy. Providence starts with it, trying to get their fifth win out of the last six and set up what could be a battle for first against Nova next week. And here is Chris Dunn, starting to emerge as a favorite for the player of the year in the conference. And Ben Bentzel coming off his best game, his first career double-double in the win against Georgetown.
Yeah, 16-11 in Washington, D.C. Just a poor closeout from Farr. Bentzel, not a very good perimeter jump shooter. And springboards Bentzel for an easy deuce. You always got to find some help with Dunn and Henton. That's a good start for Providence.
E. Davis puts it on the deck, gets cut off. Xavier's trying to get back on track. Trying to avoid their first three-game losing streak. And they go inside to Matt Stainbrook, who has his shot blocked by Bentzel.
Stainbrook's going to have one-on-one opportunities because they're not going to come double. They're going to let DeRozers go. So Stainbrook's got to make some hay down low.
Been an issue on this end of the floor for Xavier all season. Ninth in the Big East, allowing close to 70 points per game. The ball screen defense has been the biggest issue as Dunn walks. Chris Mack, head coach for Xavier, has continued to pound into his team the importance of the defensive end of the floor. And we saw practice yesterday the focus on rebounding.
Yeah, stress physicality and effort. And sometimes it's not rocket science when you're losing basketball games. It's not an X's and O's issue. It's sometimes just an effort and energy issue. And that was the big coaching point from yesterday's practice.
They got out-rebounded by Creighton by 9 on Wednesday. Especially struggled on the defensive glass. Remy Abel's 3 is contested and short. And here's Henton on the run out, getting it tipped away by Miles Davis. And back comes Remy Abel, finding Davis with a bounce for Stainbrook. And Matt Stainbrook against DeRozers. Solid defense with a foul. First of the game. Goes on to Rozers. Here's Ed Cooley in his fourth season. Providence native is on pace to increase his win total this year for the fourth time in as many years the helm of the program.
You get the sense he really likes his team. Yeah. He really likes Dunn and Henton. Thinks he's got a bunch of other junkyard dogs.
How about the season Miles Davis is putting together? Breakout season for the sophomore. And he starts Xavier's storm.
That's a three-point jumper, but the big story with him has been expanding his game to be more than just a jump shooter, but his ability to make shots really changes this Xavier team.
Carson DeRozers, his reputation is that he's a post guy because he's a seven-footer, but he can step out and hit it.
No doubt. And he's coming off a double-double at Georgetown as well, 14 points, 10 rebounds. He's important in this game because he can guard Stainbrook one-on-one in the post, and he's also starting to get his offensive game going a little bit as well.
Those 14 that he mentioned he had against Georgetown, a career high for him in a Big East game. E. Davis draws the contact and will head to the stripe for the first two free throws of this game.
Interesting matchup with D. Davis and Chris Dunn and the size and the length. Davis is checking him on the other end, and Dunn there. Never want to see your stud, your most important piece, pick up an early foul. Now Davis off the mark with the first one. These two point guards, tops in the Big East as far as the percentage of their team's assists that they account for. The number for Dunn, accounting for half his team's assists, is just ridiculous.
Unbelievable.
Yes. I mean, D. Davis is second in the conference, and he's 15 percentage points lower.
The 35% is really high.
Right.
And 50% is just ridiculous. Almost feel like you got to double and triple check that stat to see if that's right.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, we did.
And 0-2 on that trip for Davis, and then it's knocked out of bounds by Xavier. Jalen Reynolds has headed down to the other end of the floor.
He really tried to sell it, didn't he?
He
was all the way to half court. But that's a good dig, because they're going to change it. Jalen Reynolds was right.
He sold it. It's like a batter on a full count.
Yeah, talking
to the corner.
Watch the dig, though. Coming with the right hand, knocking it away. Absolutely. Off Bento's knee. Great dig from Jalen Reynolds,
who has really started to play well for the Xavier team. Number one in grade. Back-to-back 17-point games.
And the front court's been outstanding. Stainbrook and Reynolds. They just got to get some more consistent perimeter jump shooting.
There's Reynolds banking it in over DeRozier's for his first points. Back-to-back 17-point games following back-to-back two-point games, and that's been the thing through his two seasons here, is finding consistency.
Yeah, Ed Cooley talked to, excuse me, Chris Mack talked about that. The turnover from Dunn, but you got to find a way. As we take a look, watch the angle of the screen from Miles Davis. See how DeRozier's had to fight over the screen, which opened up that baseline area for Jalen Reynolds. So, you know, football is a game of inches. Basketball is a game of angles. And that was a good screening angle that freed up Reynolds.
Dunn takes his seat. He's been battling a bit of a back injury lately. And Ed Cooley was pleased with the way he saw Dunn moving around during warm-ups. He's hopeful that he'd look the same once the game starts.
Anybody that's ever battled back spasms, they can kind of linger a little bit as well.
Numbers for Providence off of the Abelmans. Dyron Cartwright into the game at point guard. And LaDonte Henton, the conference's leading scorer, collects his first two of the day.
Providence will be opportunistic in transition, and Henton gets an easy one.
So does Abel.
Abel does a nice job. He's by far the most efficient guard on this Xavier lineup. You look at what he shoots from the perimeter. He takes the right shots. Good run.
Bento, the freshman, underneath to Henton, who gets his shot blocked by Farr into the hands of Bento. It's Providence team coming off that three-point win at number 24 Georgetown on Wednesday. Their first top 25 road win since 04. Cartwright drawing the foul on Davis. And a couple of free throws coming up on the other side of the break.
Well, at home, you got to get out and run. And you take a look at D. Davis, little no-look action. And Remy is willing and able for the easy deuce in transition.
It's a rematch of an overtime game in Rhode Island back on January 22nd. Providence had a 14-point lead in regulation that was erased. Xavier sent the game into overtime, but Providence ultimately won it behind it. What has become kind of vintage Providence this season. That's a big outing from the top scoring duo in the conference. They got 44 of their 69 points from LaDonte Henton and Chris Dunn combined. So we take a look at our New York Life Keep Good Going stat of the day. These guys combined to average more than 38 points in the game. The rest of the team just over 30.
And we asked Ed Cooley before the game, do you need to find that third score? And he said, I'm so sick of people asking me that. I don't care. It'll come from somewhere. I just care about getting a team win. But when you kind of make that back nine run, for lack of a better term, and playing these teams for the second time, the familiarity level is so high in terms of a scouting report defense that it takes great individual players to get baskets. And you talk about two outstanding individual players in Henton and Dunn, and that's what allows Providence and makes them a scary team down the stretch, is they go out there and just make plays.
Dunn remains on the bench, got a couple of minutes of rest prior to that under 16 timeout, stays there, replaced by Kyron Cartwright for the point guard spot. He sinks both free throws for his first points.
Now a little 2-3 zone, Joe. This is going to be a big part of the game. what gave Xavier some issues. They kind of figured it out in the second half in their first meetings.
Here's Trayvon Blewett, top freshman scorer in the Big East, wearing five in gray. Now B. Davis lobbing one up top for Farr, who couldn't corral it. And it leads to a Providence runout. Cartwright hitting Henton, who sweeps inside and scoops it out. They'll count it with a goaltending.
Again, Providence will pick and choose their opportunities to run. And Henton is as good as anybody with a head of steam if he's got you on your heels to go finish. Just a silly pass from D. Davis. You've got to be sure about the throw when you get into the paint against this 2-3 zone.
You saw there Chris Dunn back into the game. Cartwright stays in, so really two point guards in right now for Providence.
Takes a little bit of the ball handling pressure off of Chris Dunn.
Miles Davis too strong with a runner. Reynolds gets the first Xavier rebound, and it leads to Trayvon Blewett's three ball.
That's what's been missing. Davis and Blewett from beyond the arc. This team has struggled to knock down three-point jump shots in conference play, and they need that balance on the perimeter with their great interior play.
And it's Ed Cooley's biggest concern coming into today. Seton leaves the three short. Davis pushing the other way. Good transition D for Providence, which was another one of Ed Cooley's concerns.
It's interesting. You would think with Reynolds and Stainbrook, that would be the big concern. Ed Cooley more concerned about the three-point jump shoot.
Mismatch inside. Reynolds takes advantage for a second field goal.
And his offensive game just keeps getting better and better and better. He used to just be a dunk guy or a catch-and-finish guy. Now he can face up. Has a nice little arsenal of moves in the interior.
Most efficient score in the conference at 64%. Dunn, size advantage on Davis. But Chris Mack likes D. Davis's feet. Keep it in front of the talented guard. Shot clock inside of 10. Here's Dunn. Still picked up by D. Davis. Pops in his face and knocks it down.
Joe, if he's making that, good luck. He's a guy that would rather get to a mid-range pull-up or get all the way to the basket. He's knocking down his three ball. You're in trouble.
His first points of the day. It's Providence back in front. Stainbrook gets it inside against Bentel. Matt Stainbrook has it tipped away by Henton. Here's Chris Dunn with Lindsay, who takes it to the rim and gets fouled by Miles Davis.
Such an underrated component of transition basketball is the timing of the bounce pass for the guy running the wing. And there, that was perfect timing on the bounce pass from Dunn to Lindsay, where he didn't have to put it on the deck. He could just go right it up and lay it in.
Lindsay misses the first.
So look at the timing of this. Dunn just buying time for Lindsay to go catch and right up. If he bounces it to him too early, he's going to have to put it down. Allows the defense to shift over and get in front of him. You maybe have a charge. All right. Dunn does a great job of that in transition and understanding where his teammates are and the timing of his passes.
I mean, with Dunn, the numbers are incredible, but then there's stuff that doesn't show up in the stat sheet that he does as well.
And a lot of it you can't teach. Ed Cooley's done a good job of instilling confidence in him, especially coming off some injuries. But Dunn's got some natural basketball savvy and feel that's just special.
There's another some of it there.
Yeah.
It leads to Henton bullying inside. Wild shot wouldn't go. Bodies crashing to the floor. D. Davis picked up by Dunn in transition. McCura goes baseline. Drops it off for Reynolds.
That's a great play from J.P. McCura, a guy who's a shot maker, but he's been taking the wrong shots. He comes in, could have fired one up, shot fake, drops it down to Reynolds, who dunks it.
Now only 4 points over the last three games for McCura, but creating on that trip. Etten is loose underneath to bank it in. We've had 10 lead changes over the first 8 minutes of this game.
This is going to be a good one. You definitely don't want to touch the remote. This is going to be a great one for 40 minutes.
Went into overtime, went 45 minutes. First time they met in Rhode Island on January 22nd, just a couple of weeks ago. Here's D. Davis into the corner. McCura catch and shoot off the front of the rim. And Henton goes up high for the rebound against Stainbrook.
But that's a good shot for him. Inside out, no one in front of him. That's a good shot.
Dunn, mismatch against Steenbrook. Yeah, he's stumbling backwards. That didn't go, but pretty enough. Davis with a spin, drawing the foul on Dunn. Issues defending the ball screen. How are they doing so far here?
Well, you want to look at Trayvon Blewett. Watch him come jam LaDante Henton on the roll, which buys time for Jalen Reynolds to get back to defend him in the post, and then he recovers up top to the shooter. So you let him run. Watch how he's going to come in. Jam, buy Reynolds time, and be there on the catch. Perfect. Flawless execution of pick and roll defense, which is something that's going to be crucial for Xavier all afternoon long. Great job from the freshman Blewett,
who scored several thousand points in his high school career, averaged 36 points a game. That's Nick Botsite numbers as a high school senior, but he even admitted he didn't play much defense in high school, and it's been an adjustment having to focus on that end of the floor since arriving here.
And Joe, it's an adjustment for everybody. And there aren't very many high school recruits that come in and play defense at the level and energy and focus that they need to. And so it's a learning curve for everybody. It's not just Blewett. Yeah.
D. Davis. Pascal Chukwu is another freshman. Boy, 7'2" and moves inside.
And Ed Cooley's really high on Chukwu. Thinks he's got a lot of capabilities. There's another run out from Abel, Joe.
He's able to convert. Double of 4 points. 10 minutes of this game. Xavier tries to get back on track after the loss in overtime against Creighton on Wednesday. Jalen Lindsey popping a three and knocking it down. Freshmen making their impact all over the place in this game.
That's crucial as well. We talk about the shot makers for Xavier. Providence needs a guy to step up and knock down some perimeter jump shots outside of LaDante Henton, and Lindsey could be that guy. He just hasn't shot it very good.
Yeah, dead last in the Big East shooting the three. Of course, they lost Bryce Cotton to graduation, and then Josh Fortune transferred. He's a guy they assume would kind of inherit the three-point shooting role. Save the Chukwu. Dunn with his eyes up. Lindsey again. Tipped around to Farr. D. Davis on the push, bouncing for Abel, and transition again. Scoops it in.
6 points from Abel, all in just transition layups. The guy that knocked down 4 threes against Creighton on Wednesday, and now he's doing a nice job getting out and getting easy ones in the broken floor.
Indiana transfer, first season of action at Xavier. 6 early points. Now he picks up Dunn defensively. After they had started, D. Davis up. Junior Lumumba gets blocked. That's James Farr with his second rejection. Dunn steps into a three, his second of the first half.
And 26% three-point shooter, but he's a guy that it looks good coming out of his hands. And I think he's a guy that could get to where he's a mid-30s three-point percentage type shooter.
Which would put him not near the top of the conference, but it'd be enough where you've got to respect
him. Absolutely. Then you can't go under some ball screens on him. You got to creep out, and that's when he can really hurt you by getting in the paint and spraying it out to teammates.
Blewett trying to exploit the zone and banks it in. 5 early ones for Trayvon Blewett.
The Providence, their zone is a zone that's more concerned about the perimeter than the interior. They get really spread out, so that short corner area is going to be wide open all afternoon.
Ed Cooley told us before the game, yeah, Steenbrook and Reynolds both had big games against us the first time around, but making twos. And Ed Cooley was willing to live with that if he could stop the three.
Absolutely. And you look how spread out this zone's going to get. When it goes back to the top of the key, look how high Henton's going to get. And that opens up Blewett down low. So he's able to free himself up and score. It's going to be really hard for three-point jump shots to be available in the 2-3 zone by just swinging it around the perimeter. There's going to have to be a paint touch, or the ball's going to have to get to the short corner.
That's by design for Ed Cooley, whose focus is on stopping the three-point shot of Xavier. Here's DeRozier's getting followed by Sean O'Mara, freshman.
just checked into the game for Xavier. He picks up his first foul.
Part of being a great passer, Joe, is understanding the X's and O's and how that's going to put the defense in tough spots. And Chris Dunn understands that in a great way. A little flex cut, knew that DeRozier's man would step off. Now he's at the line.
Number three in the country in assists. Autism affects one of 68 children in the U.S., the fastest growing serious developmental disorder. That's why college basketball is teaming up with Autism Speaks to raise funds and awareness this weekend. And you can too. Participate in Coaches Powering Forward for Autism. Visit autismspeaks.org/coachpower. One more for Carson DeRozers, a Wake Forest transfer. Well short. O'Meara with a rebound. Here's Makira, his first point.
I love the way he's played this afternoon. He's been struggling. I think it all started with the good decision on the baseline drive and bounce pass. They're just running the floor, same short corner spot. Blew it, got to, and he knocked it down.
They get done some rest again. Cartwright in running the point. Now here's Kenton through a double. Tapped around inside. Bentel finds it and gets fouled. So Ben Bentel will head to the line for a couple of shots on the other side of the break. And really a beautiful day outside, but that hasn't deterred the folks from filling up Cintas Center once again.
Statistics that you have to keep an eye on for the rest of this game is going to be the three-point line and the rebounding battle. Providence is going to continue to try and pound the glass, and Xavier is going to have to try and knock down some threes. And we talked to Ed Cooley. He talked extensively about how important it was to defend a three-point line. You hear that in the huddle there from Coach Cooley.
Ben Bentel at the stripe for two. He gets the roll on the first. We talked about it off to the top. They've got the top scoring duo in the conference in Dunn and Hatton. Through a lot of the year, the outside narrative has been, well, who's the third guy going to be? Ed Cooley says it doesn't matter who, but last game it was Bentel, and they'd love if he could continue to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. They need somebody, and I think it's going to be a different guy each night. It might be DeRozers one night, Bentel, could be Kyron Cartwright, Tyler Harris. But someone's going to have to step up. Because if Hinton has an off night, or if Dunn gets in foul trouble, now you really put yourself in a tough spot offensively if you're not getting any help.
So you're talking down the stretch in March, right? Because right now, they're still winning games because Dunn and Hinton aren't having the off nights. There's Trayvon Blewett. He's got seven after a career-low two the other night.
But even when you look down the stretch, having to take on Villanova, Seton Hall twice now with Isaiah Whitehead, going to have to be able to score. And I know Providence's identity is defense and kind of bullying you, but they're still going to have to try and find that third guy to help supplement and take the load off of Dunn and Hent.
Here's Kyron Cartwright. Now Dunn for Hinton. With that much room, nine times out of ten, he's going to knock it down.
Well, that possession was what Providence loves to do. Love a little continuity action, and then test your patience defensively, and then Hinton frees himself up.
And then a foul away from the ball goes on Jalen Reynolds. Just his first. This has been a pretty clean game so far. Only eight total fouls. Providence will be into the bonus on the next Xavier infraction. Stanbrook back in after a quick rest.
But Reynolds, he's always the common denominator behind little scuffles and little silly fouls away from the ball. He's got to find a way to control his emotions and not get caught in that sort of thing, because now he's developing a little bit of a reputation and guys will start looking for him.
DeRozers. And going the other way. They get a foul on Bentel. The moving screen inside.
Yeah. Kind of a little bit of like a pick rub play you see in football sometimes, as Bentel's going to kind of act like he's, hey, I'm just trying to post up, but it's a screen to free up DeRozier's driving with his right hand. Providence got it a few possessions ago and there got caught.
picked the wrong guy to play football with. Sean O'Meara is a former offensive tackle in high school, four-year starter. Tried to push him. Here's another foul away from the ball. Right after I say how clean it's been, three straight possessions with a foul. This one is number two on Chris Dunn.
It's important. Can't afford to lose Dunn to foul trouble.
Although they were okay against Georgetown after he went out with four fouls midway through the second half. Here's Makira off the glass for two. I think that had to be huge for Ed Cooley and his team to see that they could survive if they absolutely had to with Dunn in the foul trouble.
Yeah, went on a run. In fact, the run probably won the game at Georgetown with Dunn on the bench.
Finds Cartwright. Extra pass for Bentel, who's fouled by Makira. Bentel doing a good job getting to the rim this game so far.
Bench has been a big part of this game so far. 15 bench points for Xavier. Makira has come off the bench, provided a big lift for Xavier, as well as Blewett.
James Farr check back in, replacing Sean O'Meara. Chris Dunn takes a seat as well as Ed Cooley continues to try and buy him some rest as he continues to battle through that sore back. Missed the 2 days of practice leading up to the Georgetown game, and there were some questions if he'd even play. But obviously played well.
Yeah. I talked to Chris Dunn before the game, asked him how the back was feeling. Said he feels fine.
Thanks for asking. He added, right?
Yeah.
Politely.
He was polite about it. We get a first look at Tyler Harris now in the game for Providence, who had a grandparent passed away. So he's been with his family. The 25 in black is a big part of what Providence does.
No call with Cartwright going to the floor. Now a tie-up will send it to Providence.
Providence is really aggressive in this zone, Joe. They'll run through passes, and if you're weak with the ball, they'll come tie you up, dig it out.
Good turnover for Xavier. The top offensive team in the Big East. We talk about Providence having the two guys that have carried them all year. It's been the opposite story for Xavier on the offensive end. Six different players average at least nine a game.
They're a team that just hasn't shot it great from beyond the arc, but they're still really dangerous. If they can get it clicking from the three-point line, you know they're tough inside.
Cartwright slips a double, loses the handle, and another tie-up sends it back to Xavier. You were talking about the three-point shooting struggles for Xavier. There was a time where they were the number one three-point shooting team in the conference during non-conference play, but it's been compounded over the last five games, really struggling from outside. And it all started this downswing in the three-point shooting in the loss at Providence a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, they got a great post presence and a great post passer in Stainbrook that's going to lead to open perimeter jump shots, and you got to knock them down.
Double came on Stainbrook. It leads to Makira, who pops one out. Tipped around on the board, and it's Cartwright. A pull-up fouled from behind by Stainbrook. Well, that's one of the first times you've seen a double come, and as it so often does, it led to an open look that was missed.
That's really the difference for Xavier. That's when they're really tough, because you know Stainbrook's a willing passer. He's going to spray it out. And those are good looks for Makira, Blewett, and Miles Davis. Got to knock him down.
Cartwright has made all three free throws. Today, college basketball on Fox has a duel in the desert. Number six, Arizona. It's won six in a row since the loss against Oregon State. They take on Arizona State, tipping off at 4:30 Eastern on Fox. Fourth of Cartwright, all coming at the foul line, and a three-point Providence lead.
Look how extended this zone is and how long it is. You got Tyler Harris at 6'9 on the top, but that's what's open.
And James Farr getting fouled by DeRozers. It's number two on him.
It's the third time they've attacked that left short corner area in their half-court zone attack. And Xavier worked on that a ton yesterday in practice, getting the ball to the high post or looking short corner, even from the top of the key.
To be honest, though, what didn't they work on in practice yesterday?
They went a long time. You know that? It's a proud program here in it was a rough loss on Wednesday night. They got outworked by Creighton. And I know that's something that doesn't sit well with any coach, but in particular a program like Xavier that really prides themselves on outworking you and out-toughing you. And Chris Mack certainly challenged them yesterday. And so far, the X has responded.
It's a program that is no doubt taken on the personality of its head coach, former player here at Xavier. Cincinnati kid. It's Tyron Cartwright against D. Davis, now picked up by Farr.
Can't step off Henton here with Dunn on, not on the floor. Henton's the one guy that can really hurt you.
Chukwu got loose and got the bump with a bucket. Foul on Stanbrook, his second.
Great look from Tyron Cartwright and a great roll from Chukwu at 7-2. You can just kind of throw it up to him, throw it up to the rim, and he's going to be able to go get it at its highest point, turn and score. You take another look at it. See a nice little pick, roll, and replace. As Bentil's vacating to the top of the key, Farr has to, Reynolds has to vacate and get up top. Nice execution.
His four-point lead matches the largest of the game for either side. Inside of 4 minutes, opening half. A rematch of an overtime game from a little more than 2 weeks ago. Akira finding a spot in the zone for Farr. Rebound Henton.
Minutes for Cartwright here, having to run the team, knowing that he's got no choice but to do it with Dunn with two personal fouls.
Took it inside with a head of steam and lost it out of bounds. It's a Providence turnover, and it's Xavier ball. The other side of the break. Good game going on in Cincinnati. Providence with a four-point lead. Which is one four in a row. It all continues next right here on Fox Sports 1, and it streams live on Fox Sports Go.
And Roosevelt Jones has an awkward game, and there's a timing to stepping up and contesting shots. But see how he flips them up about a half a count sooner than the defense expects you to. And that makes him so effective. But this guy is a sniper. Great shooter. But the emergence of Roosevelt Jones and coming back in the lineup from the injury has really taken pressure off of Dunham to be able to make plays in the half court. Those two guys, pretty good little 1-2 punch in the backcourt for Butler, who's having a terrific season.
Our Infinity-inspired performance spotlight looks at Dunham and Jones, and it's a team that, over the last few years has gotten it done in a big way. It continues to have the personality of a team where you wonder exactly how they're in the top 25 and how they're near the top of the Big East.
They're better collectively than they are individually, and they all understand that, and they fit together perfectly. Shrabis is kind of a short, stumpy power forward. Woods is a long-rangey center. You got the shooter in Dunham, the driver in Roosevelt Jones, and then you got the glue guy in Barlow.
They design a play for Harris out of the inbound, and then timeout came late. It's a five-second call. They switched the call right after we went to break. They had initially said that it was Xavier ball, and we get there anyways, eventually. With a five-second violation.
Great. Based on out-of-bounds defense from Xavier, snipping out a lob from Tyler Harris.
Davis pops in for Reynolds, who's got a team-high 8 with his second stuff of the day. Timeout at Cooley. Xavier exploited the zone. Chris Mack with a nice draw out of that timeout. X within two. So far, and Jalen Reynolds with a team-high 8 has Xavier back to within two. He's a guy that's had back-to-back 17-point games. Matching career highs both times. And off to a good start in this one as well. Here's LaDante Henton. Through contact, but a travel.
Ed Cooley loves to do that with Henton. Just get him a driving angle with his left hand. A pretty good defense from Xavier. Feels like an important final 3 minutes for Providence. They've survived, more than survived, obviously have the lead right now, but without Chris Dunn. But it's important to finish the half strong without your catalyst.
Dunn has played only 12 of the first 17 minutes, you say only, but that guy spends a lot of time on the floor typically, and getting a touch more rest today as he continues to massage back from that A back spasm problem.
Providence having to come out of the zone going man-to-man.
Trayvon blew it, the first player into double figures. And Xavier jumps back in front inside a 2.5 in the first. Bentel for three. Nowhere close. Davis couldn't get it. Stays on this end.
But 20 bench points for the X. That's been the difference in the game. It's been those bench mob dudes coming in and lighting it up and making the right decisions, taking the right shots.
Cartwright logging some quality minutes in this first half, like he did in the second half in the win against Georgetown, with Dunn getting into foul trouble. Works around the hedge from O'Meara, finds Bentel with a finish.
You think Kyron Cartwright, through osmosis, has learned how to pass through Dunn? My goodness, was that a dime.
Yeah, he's talked about how much better it's made him having to go against Chris Dunn in practice every day. He said, if I can guard him, I can probably guard anybody in the country.
Makira too strong with his step back three. Lindsey starts to break to Cartwright, who has Hinton on the wing. And he gets fouled by D. Davis.
It's number two on Davis. 10th foul of the half since hitting the line for two shots.
I'm surprised at how much Providence has gotten out and run. They've had some long rebounds that has kind of springboarded their break. And they've had a lot of two-on-ones, three-on-twos. They've got to the free throw line. This guy always runs the floor hard. Not a secret why you score 20 points a night. You have to work to get those points.
Here's Chris Dunn continuing to rest. Dante Hinton has now started more games than any player in Providence history. Has an outside chance to become their all-time leading scorer, still with a month plus left in this season, nearing 2,000 in his career. Jed Cooley's first recruit for coming over from Fairfield. And of course, he went right to Michigan to find him.
You would know, right, Joe? Yeah.
Manhattan takes a rare rest. He plays more minutes than any player in the Big East.
Isn't it interesting, though, when you're trying to really build a program, sometimes it just takes one guy to instill the culture, the identity, and that's been LaDante Hinton for Ed Cooley.
Larry Austin into the game for Xavier, wearing zero in gray as we work near a minute left in this opening frame. Here is Austin. Freshman against freshman. Offensive foul. Good defense, Cartwright.
Xavier foul number zero. That's Larry Austin Jr. That's his first personal foul.
That was a quick rest from LaDante Hinton. Already back into the game for Providence as Chris Mack looks on. Daniel Mamumba sits down with Pascal Chukwu. O'Meara picks up Bentel. And now it's Reynolds against Hinton.
Flex action just tests your patience defensively.
Cartwright doubled, finds the open man. Lindsey, the beneficiary of the double team, and gives Providence its largest lead.
Two threes for Lindsey in this first half, but that's a great pass from Kyron Cartwright to look opposite, on time, on target, right in the shooting pocket.
Blewett forced one up there. Reynolds corrals the offensive rebound. Shot clock turned off. It's Blewett. And they had a chance to take the final shot of the half. Instead, Blewett launched it back up, and then Cartwright went down to the ground. Did he get a timeout?
Timeout, Xavier.
Looks like it'll be Xavier Ball on the other side of the break. 6-point game, 23 ticks in the first. From Jalen Lindsey.
And Kyron Cartwright's had to come in with Dunn with two personal fouls and really run the team. Keep an eye on Lindsey in the corner. He's going to flash up. A great cross-court skip pass from Kyron Cartwright. See how that ball had a lot of zip on it, and it was right to Lindsey in his shooting pocket. He can go right up into it. It's a great look from Kyron Cartwright.
And Lindsey was sixth in the first half. Providence, the worst three-point shooting team in the Big East, above 50% so far in this game. And now Xavier
with another chance
to take the last shot of the half. Cartwright couldn't get a timeout before stepping out of bounds.
So going zone. Going to try and get someone to the high post and try and look to the opposite side, either with a dive or a three.
Davis in a double, gets fouled. It's only the sixth. There's still a foul to give, 6.4 now.
A heady play from Providence and Ed Cooley.
James Farr comes in and replaces O'Meara. Davis to trigger the inbound. Blew it in the corner against Cartwright. Into the corner for Farr. His three is too strong. It brings this first half to a close. And what a first half it was. 20 lead changes between these squads. Dunn and Henton combined for 16. Blewett and Reynolds, couple of underclassmen, combined for 18 for Xavier, which trails by 6. Largest gap in this first half ends the first half. Fox College Hoops halftime update with Jill Aronson will be on the other side of the break. They'll take a few highlights across the country. We'll be back for the second in just a bit.
It's a tight game after 20 minutes of play in Cincinnati as Providence takes a 6-point lead into the break. Welcome inside the Fox Sports 1 newsroom. I'm Jill Arrington with this College Hoops halftime update. We'll get you back out to the Cintas Center in Cincinnati shortly. But first, let's take a look at some other games around the country. We'll stay in the Big East. Marquette at Seton Hall. First half, Marquette up 1. Luke Fisher gets the ball inside, finishes at the rim, and the foul. Golden Eagles up 3 after the missed free throw. Later in the half, Marquette up 11. Juwan Johnson steals it, dishes it off, gets the ball back for the layup in transition. Johnson with 9 points in the first half. Marquette up in the second. On to Creighton at St. John's. First half, St. John's up 16. Rashid Jordan throws down the baseline dunk. Take another look. He scored 19 points in the first half. St. John's up 22 at the break. Second half, Red Storm up 20. D'Angelo Harrison pulls up and hits the three. St. John's in control. The Red Storm up big late. Baylor at West Virginia, first half. Baylor up 18. Rico Gathers gets the board, throws it down on the baseline, plus the foul. Gathers had 10 points and 10 rebounds in the first half. Baylor up 16 at the break. Second half, Bears up 16. Kenny Cherry throws it ahead to Royce O'Neal for the transition dunk. Baylor with a big lead over West Virginia. Illinois at Michigan State, first half, Illinois up 1. Malcolm Hill spots up and knocks down the 3, plus the foul. Caps off a 17-4 Illinois run. Illini up 1 at the break. Second half, Michigan State down 3. Denzel Valentine lobbing it up to Brendan Dawson, who jams it home. Illinois up 4 late in the game. And later, the second half of our Big East doubleheader features DePaul visiting historic Hinkle Fieldhouse to take on number 22 Butler. And tonight on Fox Sports Live, we'll have a full roundup from a busy day on the college hardwood, including a top 10 battle between Louisville and Virginia. But that's going to do it for our College Hoops halftime update. We'll get you back out to Joe Davis and Nick Vaughn in the Queen City for the second half after the break.
Fantastic work by our production crew here in Cincinnati as we get ready to start half number 2 in Providence with a 7-0 run to finish the first. taking a six-point lead, their largest lead of the game into the second, getting 16 from the top scoring duo in the Big East. And that was with Chris Dunn only playing 12 minutes, partly because of the two fouls, partly because he's still nursing back from that back spasm problem.
Yeah, he's been dealing with back spasms, and the whole key with a bad back is getting it loose and staying loose. And he had to sit for the latter stages of that first half, and then halftime, came out really warmed up pretty hard. Keep an eye on him. He's the most important player for this second half.
He gives the ball to Henton. He led the way with 10 points for Providence. Blewett, the leading scorer for Xavier in the first half, with 10 as well. And Ben Bentel can't hit from point blank. Gets his own miss and gets fouled. Another offensive rebound for Providence. Remember, that was a big issue for Xavier, the defensive glass against Creighton. They've now allowed 6 offensive rebounds in this one.
Yeah, the glass, again, is going to be a stat. The rebounding column is going to be an important one to look at. And Xavier's got to think about all 5 guys blocking out, putting a body on people. And they worked on blocking out for about 20 minutes yesterday. Got the pads out. We're rocking each other.
Yeah, Chris Mack was laying into his team. They split him up. Blue team, white team went at it in the rebounding drills. And he let them know, I'm not going to have it. I'm not going to have our team be out-rebounded. He doesn't care who they're playing, even if it's the number 2 rebounding team in the conference with such great size, great length in Providence.
That's what Providence does. They are some glass eaters, and they try and bully you in the paint.
Blewett going baseline, getting fouled by Henton. It's number 1 on Devontae Henton. Trayvon Blewett will have a couple of free throws.
Ed Cooley
walking off the floor. With the trainer quickly behind him. That came kind of out of the blue. The play was on the other end of the floor. Blewett goes to the line, and the truck working hard to see all the angles we have to see if we can figure anything out.
Well, in the meantime, your Providence can't let that be a distraction. Your leader, your guy just walked off the floor. You're going to have to lock in for the time being.
Andre LaFleur, the associate head coach, along with Bob Simon. Both those guys got together as soon as Coach Cooley walked underneath. Right now it's Andre LaFleur that's taking the end seat and leading things for Providence. So we'll do all we can to track down any information we can on Ed Cooley, who leaves the floor a couple of minutes after coming out after halftime. Bentel trying to go by Reynolds. Lost the handle. Found Lumumba. Took the contact of it. Stainbrook, it's number 3. And it is. Third foul on Matt Stainbrook.
Tough one. Sometimes you just get caught in a bad spot defensively. Stainbrook, understanding that he has to stay in and put his fingerprints on this game. But a good attack for Lumumba.
Sophomore from Quebec. Only plays about 10 minutes a game, but Ed Cooley likes him on the floor for his toughness, the energy he brings. Never going to fill it up in the scoring column, but brings him an intangible that he craves.
They call him a ball mover and a guy that's going to defend.
1 of 2, the largest lead of the game for Providence at 7. Matt Stainbrook playing with 3 fouls, has not scored. Trayvon Blewett straight away off the front of the rim.
But this is the end of the floor that's been the issue for Xavier. Providence has gotten whatever they want. Xavier's got to put a little bit of teeth in their defense and start getting some stops. It's the only way you're going to erase a deficit.
9th out of 10 teams in the Big East down this season on the defensive end of the floor. It's continued to drive Chris Mack crazy. The bench stretches where they've played good defense. But overall, it's not been a good year on this end. Shot clock inside of 10 for Dunn. Cross court, Lumumba. Open 3.
Long rebound into the hands of Hinton, who banks out, won't go. Bentel can't follow. Blewett rips it out of the pack, and here comes Xavier. Stops. Davis pops and hits.
Beauty. You talked about Dunn's timing and transition. How about Blewett's timing? Letting Davis get his feet set and buries a big one. Xavier going now to a 1-1-3 zone, something they played a little bit of at Providence, and it bothered Providence. Ultimately, what got Xavier back in the game and forced it into overtime.
Hinton launches. Long rebound into the hands of Trayvon Blewett. Xavier looks to run with Davis. Slipping a pass for Miles Davis. Good again!
To the right of that, you see him there with his head down, and after his head down for a second, said a word or two to Andre LaFleur and then to Bob Simon, his associate head coaches, and after these free throws stood off. Slowly stands up and makes his way out of the arena into the tunnel, camera left, and has not returned. And word from a Providence official is that he's sick. So Ed Cooley feeling under the weather, and we'll continue to search for more information on that. But as it stands right now, Andre LaFleur, the associate head coach, calling the shots for Providence, which has seen Xavier go on an 8-1 run since Ed Cooley left the floor.
Yeah, Coach LaFleur had the Xavier scout, so obviously understands Xavier really well.
Ed Bentel with an up fake to get a foul on Jalen Reynolds and get two more free throw attempts. And this freshman, originally from Ghana, starting to develop that confidence that Cooley told us he was hoping he could.
He's not doing anything special in terms of making incredible efforts. He's just doing what he's asked to do within the confines of the offense. And great time out there and coming out and executing some zone offense and getting Bentel to the short corner and a good little head and shoulders fake gets Reynolds up. Not the line.
They bring Kyron Cartwright into the game with Chris Dunn. A couple of ball handlers on the floor. One more coming for the freshman Bentel. Six of his ten have come at the stripe. Rebound Stainbrook. Trayvon Blewett left alone. Transition D bites Providence. Xavier jumps back in front with an 11-2 run.
That's two times now. Blewett has just run the floor and lazy transition defense, especially off of a free throw, to not get matched up. That's inexcusable.
A game-high 15 for Trayvon Blewett. Kyron Cartwright kicking. Bentel firing. No. Rebound Blewett. Reynolds wants it, gets it, faces up on Bentel. Now Miles Davis with a pull-off, blocked by Dunn, cracked down by D. Davis.
How about that recovery, Joe, from Dunn?
Such great length.
Yeah, it's off the floor quickly.
Shot clock down to five. D. Davis finding Blewett, zips it inside Reynolds, turnaround, hook shot, no. Offensive rebound, Stainbrook. The kick, Miles Davis got it. Dunn slips inside. Bank shot, no. D. Davis carries it forward. It's Reynolds! 16-2 run, timeout, Providence!
the explosion from Xavier, riding the momentum from this crowd. Miles Davis gets things started. He now has 12 points. And a great decision by Miles Davis, D. Davis. Look at just, it all starts with lazy transition defense. No one picks up, blew it. That's off of a free throw. Inexcusable. And then off the offensive rebound, no one's matched up. Davis dials it up from downtown. And then D. Davis, when Reynolds gets it that close, it's a wrap. Eight assists for D. Davis.
And it's his 16-2 run, corresponding with Ed Cooley leaving the floor under the weather. Xavier's taking its largest lead of the game as Jalen Reynolds has gone into double figures. Xavier's knocked down four threes in the second half. Finally getting it going from outside for the first time in a couple of weeks. Now, who has the response for Providence? Tyler Harris, DeRozier's free throw line jumper won't go. Reynolds the rebound.
Now Xavier's made shots, but this zone has really changed the game and bothered Providence.
D. Davis taking it hard to the rack, drawing the foul on DeRozier's. It's number three. We'll take a break. 15:03 left. I think we're going to love every second of it. It's been a good one. It's Itsy.
It knocks one down, then offensive rebound. This one brought the Cintas Center down. What a start for this second half from downtown Cincy for the Musketeers.
And they've been struggling so much over the last few weeks to shoot it from outside. Just 20% over the last five games and right around 50% in this one. Making Ed Cooley's worst fears realized. And he told us before the game he can live with Stainbrook getting his points. He can live with Reynolds scoring. But he didn't want them launching away from three and having success like they found. D. Davis at the line. One more free throw coming. He's not necessarily loaded up the points, but he's distributed the ball well and led to a lot of those threes.
That's what he does. He just sets the table for his teammates.
How about Providence on this end now, Nick? They shot about 50% in the first half. They're 0-for-8 in the second.
It's the zone, Joe. The zone's got Providence out of off kilter, a little bit out of rhythm, and a turnover again. They're just a little bit disjointed right now looking at this Xavier zone.
Pascal Chukwu just
right off. And I think it's so important for whatever basketball team you want to talk about to have a change up, a curveball in your back pocket defensively to change the complexion of a game. When something isn't working, you've got to go to plan B, and Chris Mack has done that, and it's looked good.
Whether or not it's coincidence, the 16-2 Xavier run is corresponded with Ed Cooley going into the locker room feeling under the weather. Andre LaFleur has taken over the head duties on the sideline for the time being, associate head coach.
And it's hard to imagine that wouldn't be a big distraction. In the huddles, knowing he's not there, you can say we're not going to think about that. But that's certainly got to be on everybody's mind right now. Makira.
O'Mara strong for the rebound, but it's taken away by Dunn. He's able to save it inbounds.
This is where you got to get some looks early in transition before the zone gets set.
They're unable to. Now Hinton. Makira didn't close out hard enough for the conference's leading score, made it pay. 13 for Hinton to lead Providence.
On the road, hostile environment. Your head coach goes to the locker room. You've got to lean on your senior in LaDante Hint.
Cross court, Makira penetrates the zone. Reynolds getting double. Now D. Davis slips it in for O'Mara against Chukwu. Scoop shot, first point, Sean O'Mara.
O'Mara did a nice job of buying himself a little bit of real estate with the jump stop to give him room to get it off the window. Another good pass from D. Davis, though, Joe.
Hinton. Off the mark. Miles Davis boards it.
D. Davis pushes it. Miles Davis, his first miss from three. Wide of the foul, won't get it. Numbers for Providence. Harris can't hit. And now Makira the other way. Miles Davis. D. Davis gets rejected by Chukwu. And Chris Dunn looks to push the other direction. It's hitting against O'Mara. No foul. It'll stay on this end. And then a scuffle under the bucket. Some shoving going on after this frenetic 30 seconds or so.
Well, nothing will get your juices flowing more as a competitor than some block shots. And that's what we've seen. Some good timing on both ends. First of all, Chukwu with a great block on one end. And then O'Mara does a nice job of giving ground, and then putting his hands to the sky and just blocking it. You know, Henton was hoping for a bailout whistle.
And here you get a look at the scuffle, which results in a double technical. They're going to get Tyler Harris of Providence and Nick Jalen Reynolds of Xavier, who we've talked about his back-to-back 17-point game, starting to finally settle in and figure it out and not get into these situations, but it rears its ugly head again here.
Yeah, and you don't touch someone's head. I mean, that as a man, that just you don't do that. And Reynolds put his hands on Tyler Harris's head. And if you're Reynolds, watch his left hand. And so, you know, I guess two wrongs don't make it right, but you just don't want to get out of here. Double technical fouls on Harris and Reynolds. But if you're Jalen Reynolds, just don't get out of your own way. I mean, you've got all the talent in the world. You're starting to put it together. You don't want to be your own worst enemy here, especially when you got the momentum going in your building.
And with it being a double technical, they go from the spot where the double technical occurred, which was the ball being blocked out of bounds by O'Mara. Providence will inbound with 29 seconds to shoot. So they get that sorted out. A 7-point game that has seen just about everything. Chris Dunn gave up his dribble. It's DeRozier's elbow jumper, no. Makira with a rebound. Good transition D that time.
Got to get sorted out into these shooters now, because Miles Davis, Makira blew it. They're all kind of feeling it.
O'Mara screening for Miles Davis. D. Davis for Reynolds. Up fake for the slam and a foul.
Beautiful ball movement on the perimeter. And Reynolds just dominating post position. Watch on the inside. See how Reynolds is just going to battle. Get DeRozier's work up the floor. Get him on his hip. Look at that. That is just perfect. And they turn, not be in a hurry, and flush it.
And pick up the fourth foul on Carson DeRozier's.
A dozen for Reynolds, Nick. And Reynolds understanding post-work that you get him sealed on the high side and understand where the ball's going to come in from. It's got to come from the opposite side. So keep working, and the ball finally comes in. Great job from Jalen Reynolds.
21-4, Xavier Rund. Largest lead of the game at 10. Henton in the middle of the zone. Switches hands and banks it in.
Well, they have DeRozier's at the high post. I think Henton's a great option to get at the high post against this zone. He can shoot it, he can spray it out, and he can get to the rack.
Makira puts it on the deck, scoops it inside, and O'Mara gets fouled. The future is bright for Xavier. A lot of these guys you're seeing contributing are freshmen. That was a freshman feeding a freshman who'll go to the line in an 8-point game inside of 12. Back inside the Cintas Center, where Xavier's looking for its 200th all-time win and has an 8-point lead on Providence. Minute into the second half, Ed Cooley left the floor feeling under the weather. And Kevin McNamara of the Providence Journal tweeting that he's headed to a local hospital, his coach Cooley, and will not return today. So it's Andre LaFleur and Bob Simon, the associate head coaches, that are running things. LaFleur's been the one standing, calling most of the shots since Cooley has left. And when Cooley left, Providence was up six.
Xavier's run has corresponded with him leaving the floor. And it could be a coincidence, but you mentioned it. You're used to hearing his voice. You're used to seeing his presence in huddles, hearing him call things out. That's gone.
There's that side of it, so there's the emotional side of it, and there's the physical side of it, where the head coach has the pulse of the team and understands adjustments and different things to make right now. And Providence is really struggling against this zone. The zone has changed the game for Xavier. Providence 2 of 14 in the second half, but it's just a scary thought. Ed Cooley, he's lost over 100 pounds. He's worked really hard on his body. He said he ran 5 miles this morning. Just anybody that knows Ed, he's a joy to be around, so our thoughts are with him.
Here's LaDonte Hinton, left alone. He's got 17 to lead all scores.
Two times now, LaDonte Hinton, high post and a bucket. Could be an adjustment. Keep an eye on Hinton and getting into that free throw line area against this zone.
Both teams trying to navigate through zones. Blew it across court for D. Davis, who penetrates and bounces into a crowd. Stolen by Lindsey. Dunn on the push. And Chris Dunn sweeps to the rim. Bank shot goes.
Sometimes the best zone offense is transition offense. Beating it down the floor. And Dunn shot out of a cannon, just gliding to the rim.
8 for Dunn. O'Mara going baseline against Bentel.
O'Mara, Joe. 4 points, 3 rebounds, 2 blocks. Great minutes.
Stanbrook not scoring. And they're getting a few chipped in from O'Mara. Hinton in the middle of the zone again. LaMamba penetrates. No. D. Davis has the board. Look at the catch. He slips. And it's on a foul. I say that he stepped on the baseline, it looks like. He did step on the baseline, and Xavier turnover.
Heck of a catch from O'Mara there. Looking like Odell Beckham Jr. with the one hand pulling it down, but stepped on the baseline. So here, what? Hinton, got to get the ball to Hinton in the mid post, at the high post there. There it is.
Dunn for three. You bet. Chris Dunn into double figures with his second straight bucket.
His third three of the afternoon, and he's going to have to start to put his foot on the gas to get involved offensively and find a way to attack this zone.
Miles Davis has hit 4 threes today. Now Makura, given room, steps into a three, and he continues to struggle mightily from outside as a foul goes on Xavier on the rebound.
Good job from Dunn. Just moving the ball, being shot ready. But it all starts with getting hitting the ball into the mid post, in the high post. He sprays it out. That creates a scramble situation for the 2-3 zone. And Dunn spotting it up and knocking it down.
O'Mara sits down with his second foul. So does Makura, who is really visibly frustrated over on the Xavier bench. He's missed all 5 threes today. He's 0 for his last 16 from outside. Hinton again, center with the zone. Halfway down, popped out. Bentel with a putback. And Providence back to within two.
Be interesting now. You can feel Providence getting into a rhythm against this Xavier zone. Do you sprinkle back man or do you stick with it if you're Chris Mack?
Long rebound off of a long shot from Blewett. Pulled in by Hinton. Xavier, who had gone hot from three early in this half, has started to go cold. Reynolds with a good length to produce a steal. D. Davis against Dunn. And a foul caught on Chris Dunn, who can't believe it.
Wow. Boy, it really looked like Dunn just took his cookies. Take another look at it. How about the link from Reynolds on the zone? But good job by Dunn just giving ground. Ooh, I don't know.
Not many guys can do what he did and have us be able to argue that it wasn't a foul. His third.
The Big East leading score or leading
assist man. Steals.
Yeah, thank you, John. He looked like he just took it, but his third personal foul.
So he sits. Cartwright comes in. Thank you. Steenbrook, their leading scorer, scoreless today. Gave up his dribble. Dee Davis on the drive, left it off for Reynolds. He'll stuff it down. And Chris Mack calls a timeout. 11th assist for Dee Davis, and Jalen Reynolds now with 15. Tied with Trayvon Blewett for a team high. Don't miss a single Big East basketball game this season. You can add the full 2015 schedule to your calendar. Tweet hashtag Big East at Fox Sports 1 and then check your notifications. You used both those this morning, right?
I did. I follow instructions, Joe.
Uh-huh.
You know, whatever these promos tell me to do, I'm going to do it. I included you on the tweet, man.
I appreciate it very much. Look at all these people tweeting.
Yeah.
Wow, even the mascot.
It looked like he was trying to get a selfie.
I think he is. Sean O'Mara has played a total of 6 minutes over the last six games. Didn't score. He's got five today with Steenbrook struggling to get it going in his 11 minutes. And it's not just been the points, a couple of blocks as well.
That's hard when you're a bench player, never knowing when your minutes and your opportunity is going to come. But you got to prepare the same way every single night because you never know.
Bento with a pretty hook shot over Reynolds. Safe to say this freshman's gaining confidence.
Yes, it is. And that's something Matt Cooley talked about before the game. It's amazing what one good game can kind of do for you. Get a double-double at Georgetown. Get a little drenched in confidence. Seeing it today.
He had 16 in that win against Georgetown. He's got 14 today. Here's Miles Davis. Bank shot wouldn't go. Bentel with a man's rebound. It leads to transition. Hinton scoops it in. And we're tied again inside of 8 minutes.
Well, Providence has started to settle in offensively. Got a few easy ones from the high post against his own. Broken floor there. Rick ball fake from Hinton for the finger roll.
So Providence has battled back from down 10 to equal the issue at 62. Reynolds at the high post finding Abel. Now Blewett fading. Short. Providence with a chance to go back in front.
Dee Davis and Ben Bentel matched up, but Dunn lines it up.
Good box out from Dee Davis on the much bigger Bentel, like you mentioned. And flew it on the drive. Left hand. Got it for the Xavier lead.
The pace from Blewett. Just taking what the defense gives you sometimes in transition. Just got to probe into the paint. See if anyone stops you. No one did.
Dunn running the baseline. Getting the ball against Davis. Dunn with a beautiful find for another tie. It's Bentel on the other end of it. Top 10 of the country in assists. Showing great vision to hit the freshman underneath. Two more for Bentel, who's matched his total from the Georgetown game with 16. Chris Mack takes a timeout.
Quite an answer from Providence here to settle in. Illustrated earlier the importance of bumping. The roll man. Take a look at Blewett. He did a great job in the first half of doing it here. No bump. Leads to an easy basket. Blewett executed his defense assignment in the first half. No basket there. Mental mistake. Doesn't bump the roll man. And Dunn always will find that roll man if you don't stop it.
21 lead changes and 8 ties in this game. And again, Ed Cooley no longer in the building. Left the floor 1 minute into the second half with an illness. And has gone to a local hospital to be checked out. Andre LaFleur and Bob Simon, the associate head coaches, have taken over the bench duties. And right now they make the decision to sit Chris Dunn with 6:26 left. They've continued to get him rest. Partially, you would assume, because of the back spasms he's gone through. Partially because he's been in foul trouble. He's got 3 right now.
And an impressive answer, though, from Providence on the road. This place was rocking. 3's going down. It's Blewett with a nice floater. Showing you why he's the freshman Big East leading scorer.
19 to lead Xavier. 1 game after a season low 2.
And now back man-to-man, Joe. Which I think is the right move from Chris Mack.
Patton for three.
Boy, that one rolled around and popped out to Reynolds.
I like this. High ball screens from Blewett. Gets the top two guys disjointed.
Shot clock winding down. Hits Blewett. Shot contested. And it fell into the hands of Jalen Lindsay. Cartwright running the point with Dunn on the bench. Never far from the scorer's table, though. Lindsay, size advantage on Davis. Now Lumumba, push it off. Offensive foul. Xavier had opened up a 10-point lead, but Providence has climbed back in it with 4:56 left. It's a 2-point game, and LaDante Hetton trying to continue the comeback. Exciting Saturday in Big East action. Boy, St. John's taking care of business against Creighton behind 25 from Rasheed Jordan. Marquette with an upset win against Seton Hall without Matt Carlino, who is out with a concussion. Georgetown and Villanova from Philadelphia going on Fox right now. Can Villanova bounce back from that 20-point defeat in D.C. a couple of weeks ago and hang on to first? Providence would love to come from behind in this one and set up what could be a battle for first place in Rhode Island next week on Fox Sports 1.
Does feel like Georgetown, Butler, Providence, and Villanova have separated themselves a little bit from the pack, but this is going to be a really exciting conference race down the stretch, and we got an exciting game down the stretch here in Cincinnati with Xavier and Providence.
It's been tied 8 times. You've had 21 lead changes. Xavier's led by as many as 10. Providence is led by as many as 8. Kicks out of bounds, and will stay on this end. Chris Mack hoping his team can bounce back from that loss against Creighton on Wednesday, which most pundits would tell you has put him back squarely on the NCAA tournament bubble with a month left in the regular season. Dee Davis can't hit. Makira misread the rebound, and it falls to Dunn. Chris Dunn so quick, can't hit it. Tip out, goes to the bench, nobody home.
I think Xavier needs to be careful here on not just settling for threes against this zone, because that's not a great shot from D. Davis. He's been much better suited getting in the paint and spraying it out to teammates. Got to still try and go inside and get easy shots at the rim and then maybe spray it out for some triples. There you go.
Stainbrook hitting Reynolds, reverses it in, and Jalen Reynolds has matched his career high, his third straight game with 17.
And now the decision for Chris Mack on this end is whether to stay zone. He stands zone here, but in zone you're matched up to an area, not really a man, and it's important to match up to LaDante Hetton. Good steal from Davis.
They try to slip it into Hetton. He lost it. D. Davis on the push. Makira plus the foul. .45 of the .70 have been from the bench for Xavier.
Just an incredible decision again from D. Davis. Goes to Makira. 3 to Hardway.
Here in Marquette, will try and build off of the momentum of the win against Seton Hall today. All begins Tuesday, 7 Eastern on Fox Sports 1, streaming live on Fox Sports Go. 47 points from the Xavier bench. They don't make them much more intense than Chris Mack. Watch the right side of your screen.
Watch him come in and go right after D. Davis. Going to come in. There he is. Right there. As he comes in and goes right to his team and gets fired up. How awesome is this? Look at the emotion. Look at the energy from Chris Mack going to his guys. You don't think he wants this one and understands how big this is, this game is? And he should be going after D. Davis. You know how hard it is to control a game and not make a shot? And that's what D. Davis has done. So many guys put their fingerprints on games by scoring. He's done it by distributing the ball. He's 0 for 2 from the floor, but he's got 13 assists. What a game from D. Davis.
Providence had battled back from down 10 to tie it. 7 in a row for Xavier. 7-point lead inside of 4. DeRozier's back on the floor with 4 fouls. Feeds Lumumba. Now Hetton. Screening for Dunn.
Hatton is open for three. Off the iron. Lumumba tips it up. It falls down to Stainbrook.
What a great pass from Dunn. That's about as good of a look for your stud in Hatton as you could ask for.
Hatton leading the way with 19, but he's just 1 for 6 from outside today. Stainbrook, middle of the zone.
Makira corner three. Got it. Snapping it 0 for 16 from outside for the freshman. Hatton responds. Big shot. Senior answering the freshman.
Gotta love the confidence shown by both guys in big moments to let it fly with no hesitation.
Snapping a 10-0 Xavier run, 22 for the conference's leading scorer, LaDante Hatton.
Dunn nearly gets a steal. Stainbrook sprawling to the floor.
I believe they've caught him for the foul. They get Matt Stainbrook for his fourth.
Boy, that's a tough call because that's a 50-50 loose ball. And you usually want to reward the guy who gets to the floor first, and it was Matt Stainbrook. But heck of a defensive effort from Chris Dunn.
Both teams in the bonus now, 1-1 in the next foul each way. 7-point game inside at 2.5. Remember when these teams met up in Rhode Island a couple of weeks ago? Xavier racing a huge deficit to force OT. Providence trying to do the same. Dunn short with a three. Scramble for the rebound. Possession arrow would send it to Xavier. Instead, Stainbrook gets a timeout. And they maintain the possession arrow with 2:13 left.
A good hustle for the rebound on both ends. Both guys stepping up. On both sides of the floor here with Xavier knocking down a big one from Akira and then getting after it for the loose ball rebound.
Getting into crunch time in the season. Xavier had such a tough January. 6 of its 9 games are on the road. 5 of its 7 Big East games in the month of February are at home. They'll be at home next Saturday against St. John's on Fox. And at Cincinnati, first time that game will be played on campus since the brawl a few years ago. Not an easy finish for Butler, St. John's, and Villanova before going to Creighton. And for Providence, trying to set up a big matchup with Villanova next Wednesday. Villanova right now taking on Georgetown over on Fox. They still got to play Villanova twice over the final month of the season. And again, you see Andre LaFleur, along with Bob Simon, the associate head coaches, 1 minute into the second half. In the case that you're just joining us, that Cooley left the floor and has gone to the hospital feeling ill. Some pressure from Providence out of the inbound that D. Davis breaks. Dunn pestering.
You got to be really aware of where Chris Dunn is at. Really good at running through passes, poking the ball away.
He defends D. Davis.
Makira's wide open. Short. Dunn the board. Starts the break to Hatton. Numbers for the Friars. Hatton scoops it up. Off the front of the rim. Two shots coming up on a foul on D. Davis.
It's a big time outlet pass through a double team by Chris Dunn to springboard the fast break and the 2-on-1 for LaDante Hatton. That's a nice job from Dunn to get it out quickly.
You were telling me that before the game. There's sometimes where in one motion he'll get the ball and start the break, and 9 times out of 10 it's to him.
He does a great job of pitching ahead in transition. Oftentimes it's off of an outlet pass, but there was off of a rebound, and Hatton does a good job of running the floor.
Some blood on the hand of Matt Stainbrook. They get it cleaned up, get him back into the game. LaDante Hatton, who has made both free throws today, will have 2 here to try and bring it back to 2 possessions.
They
making a program record 124th career start today. 5-point game, 1:45 left. Stainbrook wants it against DeRozers. Now screening for Miles Davis, who turned it over. And Chris Dunn against D. Davis. What a steal from D. Davis. Numbers for Xavier. And the senior pulls it out to run clock.
Big time steal.
1 minute in a thriller in Cincy. And a foul on Jalen Lindsey after they had half of the shot clock run out. They now send Miles Davis to the line for 1-1.
Well, great job by Davis. Just backpedaling, quick hands, going right at it. Take another look at it. Great job to give ground, and understand I got one chance to go get it. He's probably going to come with a little high Euro step, bring the ball over his head. And then an interesting decision to pull out when he had the 3-on-1. Now Davis, who's a pretty good free throw shooter, that's an understatement, rewards the good decision from D. Davis.
Best foul shooter in the Big East. One more coming.
How about D. Davis?
Oh my goodness.
Just incredible.
Can you have a bigger impact on the game like you saw without scoring?
No, but 14 assists, the biggest steal of the game.
The deficit is 7 inside of a minute. Jalen Lindsey bricks a 3. Dunn can't corral it. Here's Davis. Whoa! Jalen Reynolds! My goodness! And now a steal from Akira. Chris Mack says throw on the brakes. Providence waves the white flag. Xavier's going to take it. With a hard-fought win. Jalen Reynolds caps off a career-high 19 with a thunderous slam on a ball bounced off of the backboard by D. Davis. His 15th assist, an apropos way for this one to end. 78-69, Xavier wins it. After trailing by 8 in the first half, they had a 10-point lead disappear in the second. But able to hold on for the win. Look at that. Elevation from Reynolds. We're standing out of the Fox College Hoops studio. Rob Stone, take it away.
What a closing run there by Xavier as we welcome you to the Ford Fox Sports 1 College Hoops. Sponsored by Ford. Go further. Billy Garrett Jr. Yeah, he's paced DePaul all season long in rebounding and in points. Up next is surprising Blue Demons looking for an upset of number 22 Butler. That one next here on Fox Sports 1. Rob Stone, Kevin O'Neill, Austin Crozier in studio with you. Before we get out to Indy, let's talk about what just went down in Cincinnati. And Jalen Reynolds with perhaps the one today with an exclamation on a big win for the Musketeers.
No, one of the most impressive games that we've seen from Xavier, and they really needed it offensively. 24 of their 29 field goals were assisted. D. Davis, who I think is the best passer in the conference, goes for 15 assists in this game. They had to have the win, Coach, and they came out and played like
that. Yeah, and what Xavier now needs to do is try to carry this on the road. They got to be a little bit better road team. They took care of business at home. They attacked the basket. Their bigs were passing the ball interior on the interior, finishing everything around the rim. They dominated the end of the game and played like they need to be a good team.
This is a Xavier team that's disappointed you the last couple weeks. You have high expectations for them. What was different today in them that maybe gives you some renewed hope that they can go deep?
They always play better at home, I think they've really underachieved because they've got size, they got depth, they got a great point guard. I mean, they have all the things they need. What they did today is they played like they really needed to win.
Jalen Reynolds and Trayvon Blewett are the two guys that have kind of been up and down. They played huge here today.
And we're going to get a little bit more on Ed Cooley and his health situation as well. But first, let's get it back out to Cincy. Nick Baugh with Musketeers head coach Chris Mack.
Thanks, boys. Well, Coach, tough loss on Wednesday. Was it just about effort the last few days in terms of challenging your team?
A little bit. I first want to just, you know, let Ed Cooley, Providence, and everybody know that he's in our prayers. Hopefully everything's fine. Ed's a terrific person. He's got a great program. And, you know, just happy that our guys responded in the second half the way that we did. You know, I think the zone, both there and here, was really, really effective. At times, I don't know how, but this guy's toughness level and the rest of our players stepped up in a major way here in the second half.
Talk about what you like most about Dee Davis. It's pretty hard to control a game without making a field goal, and he did it.
You know, he sacrificed a lot. I've asked him to be more of a pass-first point guard, and I think, you know, just today's world that everybody, you know, wants to be the guy. And he's done a terrific job of sacrificing that. Even last game, he goes 9 assists, no turnovers. You know, he's the smallest guard in our conference, but he plays with the biggest heart. That steal he had against Chris Dunn at the end in transition, phenomenal. We don't win the game if we don't make plays like that, and he's a big reason why.
Congrats, Coach.
Thanks, Nick.
You're bringing Dee Davis. Heck of a performance. You knew you were going to see a little bit of zone, a little bit of man. And you were able to distribute the ball at a high level. Take me into what you were looking for when you were going against the zone and against the man-to-man this afternoon.
Man-to-man, I was just, you know, I could beat my guys. It was one-on-one. To create somebody else to come up and help. And it was really easy to pass the ball, you know, in the middle of the zone, just getting in gaps.
Talk about the last few days. Tough loss on Wednesday night. You guys have been really good in this building. Tough loss to Creighton. What was the biggest message from Coach over the last 2 days to get ready for this one?
Coach was just telling us to, you know, play with heart and play hard and play with effort. You know, you can't coach effort. I mean, you can do all the drills you want, but if you're not having any effort in the game, it ain't going to work out for you. So that's all he's been preaching. You know, the last couple of days he's been practicing really hard.
About that last one off the glass to Jalen.
Yeah, he's been asking me for one all night. Every break he asked me for a lob, got mad at me, so the last one I just let him have it. Yeah.
Beautiful game.
Thank you.
Boys, back to you in the studio.
All right, Nick, thank you. The 200th win for Xavier at the Cintas Center, a convincing victory. But one of the stories underlying this one, the health of Ed Cooley. He left the bench in the second half, had been fighting a stomach virus, but also complaining of some breathing issues.
Yeah, I talked to Kevin McNamara, the longtime beat writer for the Providence Journal, and he mentioned that he had stomach issues coming into the game. He left after getting sick on the sideline, but also complaining of some breathing issues. He's been checked into an area hospital, and obviously updates will be coming. But this is a coach that has as close of a relationship with his players as I have ever seen. And there's no question that everyone is thinking about Coach Cooley right now.
We'll update you throughout the day. And again, the team really started to falter once Coach Cooley left the bench and went into the locker room. Here's Mike Henry. He's been in double figures in six of his last seven games for DePaul, the 6'6 junior, trying to get the Blue Demons their seventh conference win of the campaign already. What a great season, an unexpected season for DePaul. We're on Fox right now, number 7, Villanova.
Stealing my moves.
In the mood pregame, hosting Georgetown. Daniel Oshefu.
There's a completely different defensive presence from Villanova in this game. We talked about the slow starts they've had in three of their last four games. They came out like a team that had to get back on track and really reaching their potential, KO.
You know what? When Villanova plays with this kind of energy, you're not going to beat them at home.
No.
Impossible. And this is the best I've seen them play in a long time. I thought they were starting to plateau a little bit. They look like they're playing a lot better today.
Darren Hilliard with 14 at the break. Nova up 14. Marquette at Seton Hall. Juwan Johnson, Steve Taylor.
You like the baby blues, right?
I do. I do. Golden Eagles up 9, under 2 to go. Marquette up 3. Mobley goes glass. 1-point game. Now a 3-point game. Sterling Gibbs.
He's hit a number of big ones.
Not today.
Great play, great look, bad law.
First road win of the season for Wojo. Creighton at St. John's, Rasheed Jordan, and the Red Storm all over the Blue Jays today.
He's been phenomenal the last couple games with Chris Obekpa playing virtually not at all in this game. They go with five guards and completely run Creighton out of the gym.
Jordan had a game-high 25. St. John's was up 22 at the break. Yeah, Sir Dominic Poynter with the rejection. And could I have another, please? Yes. He finished with 8 blocks. So we take a look at our updated Big East standings. Villanova in action right now over on Fox, hosting Georgetown. They're on top at 7-2. Providence, their loss dips them to 7-4. And there's DePaul coming up next on the road at Butler, sitting there at 6-5 in 5th place in the Big East. The top 10 showdown in the ACC coming up next. Would number 4 Duke get revenge on Notre Dame? This bumper may be giving things away. Andrew Travis averaging 20 points in his last 3 games. His Bulldogs eye their 18th win next. And for more on our matchup, send it out to the guys calling the game, Dick Stockton and Ron Thompson.
All right, Rob, 2 of the big surprises in the Big East get to square off here at Hinkle Fieldhouse in Indianapolis, and it's going to be Butler against DePaul. Butler ranked 22nd and won 4 in a row, and they're paced by Kellen Dunham, a sharp shooter from outside, who's the leading scorer on the team.
And boy, can he knock him down. When you look at the Big East as a whole, he's one of the top 5 three-point shooters in this league, and he does it in several different ways. He does a good job at coming off of screens. He's a very good catch-and-shoot kind of a guy, and he's worked on his game, and that 1-2 pull-up jumper, he's got down to a science. I love his 6'6 frame. When he raises, the defenders can't even see him. But the one guy that makes this engine go for Butler is this guy right here, Mr. Roosevelt Jones. Look at those stats. His numbers aren't gaudy, but at the end of the night, his DNA is all over this court. He scores it, he puts it on the deck, he distributes it, he rebounds it as well. And when the Butler Bulldogs need a bucket, when they need a play to be made, they put the ball in Mr. Jones's hands and get the heck out the way.
And Ron, DePaul has already doubled their win output in the Big East from last year. They have 6 wins in the conference, and of course, the heart and soul of this team remains Billy Garrett Jr.
Billy Garrett has really grown. What a difference a year makes from his freshman year when he was Rookie of the Year to this season. His numbers, not a huge jump there either, but he is the guy that makes the final decisions, either from scoring the ball or from penetrating and pitching. He thoroughly understands Oliver Purnell's offense right now.
Well, Butler is 11-1 at home. Meanwhile, they have never beaten DePaul here at Hinkle Fieldhouse. We'll see what transpires today, Rob.
All right. Dick, we appreciate that. What a season Chris Holtmann has put together for Butler, the interim head coach coming into the campaign, then finally handed the reins. Not much was expected of Butler. Here they are at 17-6 and one of 3 Big East teams ranked in the top 25 this week. Speaking of ranked teams, Notre Dame, remember 10 days ago they beat Duke by 4 points. It was payback time in Durham. Tyus Jones for 3, part of a 14-0 run for Duke. Later in the half, Jones, Quinn Cook, corner 3. Duke up 22.
Now, the freshmen are really coming along for Duke, not just Jahlil Okafor, but when you look at Tyus Jones, when you look at Winslow, those guys aren't having the same highs and lows that they had earlier in the season. And this is looking like one of the best teams in the country without question. Oh,
a lot of dead bodies come out of Cameron.
Okafor, the bucket there. Okafor will get the rebounds. And 1.
Oh, good.
Number 1 pick?
Yes.
To the Big 12.
Yep.
No question. Yeah.
Number 8,
no question.
Kansas on the road, Oklahoma State. Frank Mason for 3.
Now, we talked about Kansas.
You know, Brandon Green.
The year looking like a team that maybe can be vulnerable. They have answered every critic and just are rolling through a very good Big 12.
Wayne Seldon Jr.
I thought Texas could win it.
Kansas up 12. Mitchell Solomon. Yeah! Cowboys are feeling it. And then Frank Mason again. Kansas up 11 at the break. Number 19, Baylor.
This was one of the most surprising games early on. West Virginia down huge.
Rinko gathers
at home.
At home. Dominant. I think the game started 22-3.
Lord.
Talk about the depth of the Big 12 again. Here is another example of it.
Kenny Cherry to Royce O'Neal. Butler on the road, an impressive victory. Texas Tech on the road at number 11, Iowa State. Jameel McKay alley-oop. Iowa State up 19 at this juncture. Devontae Williams drives, blocked by McKay on the other end. McKay.
Tough place to play.
45-23 in the second half. What are we to take away from Duke and what we've seen from them? They were showing maybe some cracks, and they lose a player that Coach K kicks off the team, and then all of a sudden what they're doing to Notre Dame is telling you what about the Blue Devils?
I think that this is probably the best team in college basketball.
Kentucky
is the most talented team. There's no question about it. And if they were to play, a game, I'm not saying that Duke would win the game. But so much in college basketball is overreacted to over a couple of losses that they had earlier in the year.
And you've been talking to Dickie V too long.
Look, they haven't lost to Notre Dame. They bounced back. They beat an undefeated Virginia team on the road. They bounced back, beat the number 8 team in the country by 30 points.
Crow's lost his mind.
They're a good team.
Are they the
second best team?
I don't know that. I think Virginia's the second best team. Even though they lost to Duke, that happens. Duke is a very good team that is improving. I'll give you that. And their freshmen are really doing a good job. But Mike's only got over 1,000 wins, so I'm worried about their coaching down the stretch here at the ACC. It's going to hold them back.
Duke's fourth win versus a top 10 team this season.
Impressive.
Amazing, amazing. A little bit later today over on Fox, number 6, Arizona battles Arizona State in Tempe. The Cats at 20-2 with a half-game lead over Utah in the Pac-12. Catch the duel in the desert, 4:30 Eastern over on Fox. Jamie Crockett and DePaul on the road, about 14 and a half minutes away between DePaul and Butler. And here's DePaul head coach Oliver Purnell in this edition of Keep Good Going, brought to you by New York Life.
Basketball has been everything to me. I grew up playing basketball, won a national championship in college, went on to work as a coach because of my playing career, and obviously I've made a living doing it and raised a family and all of those good things with basketball. It's taken me all over the world. I don't know what I would do without it.
10 and a half minutes. Here's a look behind the scenes inside a Butler practice.
Here we go. Active on the ball here. Active on the ball. Good. Hand in. Good. Be in a stance. Don't hold him, Tyler.
Our practice habits are paramount to our success.
Before the ball arrives. Work before the ball arrives.
We want aggressive, physical, up-tempo, detailed practices, and we expect that out of our guys.
Come on, KD. You gotta be more active. You gotta stay on your feet, my man. Stay down, Keelan. Good.
I think we approach practice with a lot of passion each and every day. We're excited to get better, and I think that was missing a little bit last year, and I think it kind of wore on us late in the year.
Good job, KD. Way to get in there. Good. Next group.
People have already been starting to say that we look like the old Butler teams that play hard, grinding out defense.
Good. High hands. Good.
Last year in the Big East, we were eighth in the league in defensive efficiency and ninth in the league in offensive efficiency. So those are both areas that we need to be better at, and we try to do that here early on.
Run, Tyler. Opposite the ball. Big, shouldn't have to tell you, get opposite the ball. That was good, Tyler. Wyman, you did a good job there.
Coach Ullman, he challenges us each and every day by putting us in situations to compete against one another. He breaks down things when we're confused or we get discombobulated during practice.
How does that happen where we're not matched up? All right, I think a lot of it's trotting and jogging.
I do like to get in there and get involved as much as I can with them. I'm relatively young, so the ability to kind of still move and operate and do things with them is more my style and more my pace.
Good. There we go, good.
We're going to make sure we do everything 110% because we know it's going to affect how we play in the game.
Good, Rose. Good, White. Great job on the glass.
The real measure of our team this year will be how we respond to the ups and downs of the season. And I certainly hope the people that watch Butler see a really spirited, tough, physical team that makes them proud to watch.
Saw and heard a lot from Chris Holtman in that piece. What he's done this season, describe it for me.
National Coach of the Year. It's like jumping on a train to be the interim coach, and you're unsure of your situation. The players are unsure. He obviously sold his players on a vision of what the season would be. They followed through, and they're a very good basketball team.
You've done that transition. How much of a challenge is
it? It's hard. It's very hard to do, and it's one of those things that the players know you're not really the coach.
Yeah.
When he became the coach in January, and I give the administration credit for making him the head coach and given him the job and a long-term deal, that solidified who he is.
Let's get to some impact players in this one. Alex Barlow is yours. Why, Austin?
Yeah, the senior point guard for Butler. I think he's kind of the glue guy that keeps this entire team together. He's coming off of two of his best games of the season, averaging 15-5-5, shooting close to 60% from the field. His improvement this year has taken so much defensive pressure off of Kellen Dunham because he's now keeping defenses honest. At the defensive end of the floor, he's actually second in the conference in steals, doing a very good job for Coach Holtman, kind of the extension of the head coach on the court.
He's been in double figures in 7 of his last 10 games. KO, who else, right? Billy Garrett Jr.
Billy Garrett, second best guard in the league. I think he's done a wonderful job of directing his team. He plays with tenacity. He always looks under control. Mm-hmm. He actually looks a little slow sometimes. He looks like he's not going hard, but he's one of the better players in the country.
DePaul, 12-12, 6-5 in the conference. Raise your hand if you thought DePaul would have 6 conference wins all season, much less here they are, and they are an absolute factor in the Big East. So DePaul at number 22, Butler coming up in just minutes. Cameron Woods, nobody rebounds more effectively in the Big East than that big man. Tip-off coming your way in just about 6 minutes from Indy. Tuesday, make sure to catch a Big East doubleheader here on Fox Sports 1. The Hoyas take on Seton Hall at 7 Eastern. That one followed by Xavier battling Marquette. Both of those Tuesday live on Fox Sports 1.
My wife's got me into House Hunters, which I'm a little embarrassed to say, to be quite honest. But I have enjoyed that. I don't have many hobbies because I've thrown about 4 of my pitching wedge and sand wedges in the local ponds there in Indianapolis. I think I've given that hobby up for a while.
I like to play video games, especially FIFA. I like to watch the History Channel, Pawn Stars, American Pickers, any cool documentaries, and then I really just like to watch any basketball on TV.
I love to fish. I like to cook. I just like to be in the kitchen and try new things. I wouldn't say I'm an expert, but I'd say I'm getting there. I'm just a big jokester. People on the team say that I make people laugh all the time, and I'm just like the life of the party whenever I'm with my friends.
There's your Butler build. So Chris Holtman also has problems holding on to golf clubs like somebody I know lost a few. Temper. One of the big factors in this one, in your eyes, rebounding. Why?
I think it's going to be a big story. Even though Butler's not one of the bigger teams in the conference, they are the best rebounding team in the conference, and that's an area where DePaul really struggles. So I think that they're going to have their way down low. The other biggest strength for DePaul is the three-point shooting, a big reason why they have 6 wins in conference. Butler, the best defensive team against the three-point shot. I think they're going to run them off.
Live intros right now for Butler as the starting 5 come out. They routed St. John's Tuesday by 23 points, KO. Had 46 points in the paint.
Well, they're an old-fashioned team.
Yeah.
They attack the basket. They get to the paint. They defend. They wear on you physically, mentally.
Really don't have any weaknesses. No. This is a great team.
That's why they're ranked. Butler, DePaul. Right now, let's get it out to Hinkle Fieldhouse. Dick Stockton, Ron Thompson with the call.
All right, Rob, and thank you very much. It is always special to be at Hinkle Fieldhouse in Indianapolis. Today is no exception. Sellout crowd to watch the 22nd-ranked Butler Bulldogs against the DePaul Blue Demons. And right now, Butler has undisputed possession of second place in the Big East because Providence lost to Xavier earlier, and they're challenging Villanova, winning in their game in the Big East. And welcome, everyone, to Hinkle Fieldhouse. Dick Stockton and Ron Thompson, and both these teams, Ron, have exceeded expectations, especially Butler. They've won 4 in a row, and this team is on a definite roll.
It just epitomizes why you have to play the game. Butler was picked in the middle of the pack in the preseason. They've steadily climbed their way up the charts. The way they get after it is in a team, selfless sort of way. They spread the wealth. They don't care who scores. They take advantage of matchups. They just do a solid, solid job on the offensive end. And boy, they get after it defensively.
Let's take a look at the starting lineup, starting with the Bulldogs, and they have The same five starting every game this year. Kellen Dunham is their leading scorer, and Cameron Woods a monster off the glass. Meanwhile, DePaul, a much deeper team than Butler coming into the game, and of course, their leading scorer and playmaker, Billy Garrett Jr., and Rashawn Simmons starting his third straight game. He's going to have to play big against a good rebounding team in Butler. Oliver Purnell has turned this team around. They won only three games in the conference last year. They've doubled it with 6-5 coming into this game. And what a great story for Chris Holtman, who was an interim coach when Brandon Miller had to leave because of medical reasons. Now he is the full-time coach and has really guided this team in his first season as the head man. And the opening tip controlled by Butler. Gary Prager, Jeffrey Anderson, and Matt Potter are the officials today.
DePaul's really going to have to do a good job today at having defensive concentration because Butler doesn't mind winding the shot clock down.
Andrew Chavez gets the scoring underway, and he has been a force for Butler. They beat St. John's on Tuesday, scoring the last 15 points of the game.
Travis did an outstanding job the game before that against Marquette. Marquette reported in 30 points. He was absolutely unstoppable in that matchup.
DePaul going low, and the turnaround shot. Stimmich misses, so does Mike Henry. Here's Jones, loses the dribble. Here's Chavez again. This one off the rim. DePaul beat Seton Hall at home Tuesday, 75-62. They have not been under 500 all year in the conference.
If you're Oliver Purnell, you can't keep allowing Travis to catch the ball that close to the basket because he can use either hand around the basket. You have to do your work early and push him as far out on the court as you can.
Billy Garrett Jr., and they have Stimmich trying to set a screen at the top. Three-point shot. And it goes. Darrell McDonald, known for his defense, hits a three. DePaul leading by one.
That was great patience, that possession by DePaul. They worked it from side to side. Multiple guys touched it. And Butler, on the other hand, when you're guarding DePaul, you've got to really man up because each of their guys, even the subs that come in, are very, very skilled offensively. They can all go get their own shot.
Alex Barlow and Schrabis from the top. And that'll drop through. Schrabis with a three. Has scored all five Butler points with 2 minutes gone by.
You can't be surprised by anything that you're seeing Travis do. He can score on the low block. He can shoot the ball facing. He can even put the ball on the deck and get to certain spots. And Butler, this is what they do. They don't care who scores the points. They take advantage of matchups and open opportunities.
They are not a deep team, however. Let's see if DePaul can take advantage of that. Here's Henry stepping back. Misses the two. And the follow-up is knocked away, tapped out. And another possession, and here is Henry driving in, and Henry scores, changing hands. Mike Henry, good all-round player, second leading scorer, and top rebounder, transfer from Illinois, and he's really given this team a big boost.
Did you see how Henry, when he drove, he gave the defender his body? Great job that by Henry in doing that. Scorers know how to get that ball to the backboard.
Dunham, the leading scorer, and it comes off the rim and the rebound taken down by Henry. Butler has the edge in rebounding in this game, but perimeter shooting, you have to go DePaul's way, and can they do anything about it? And we have a foul called, and that'll be the first foul of the game against Butler, and it's against Cameron Woods.
On this drive, Henry does an excellent job of giving Woods his body and his shoulder, just enough to get that ball up over his outstretched hands. And when you attack that basket, especially against Butler, it gets really physical when you get in that paint.
And a timeout called as Billy Garrett Jr. couldn't get the ball. Good defense that time, and they're going to take the timeout. Furious early moments here between DePaul and Butler. Georgetown today, they will also have won four in a row, which is the longest winning streak for any team in the conference this year. Two,
if you notice defensively, Butler, they won't chase their defenders way out beyond the three-point line. But once you get inside that three-point arc is where they really lock in and starts to get really physical.
Billy Garrett with the drive, and that's what he does best. He's gone to the free throw line 64 times more than the next DePaul player. So he attacks the rim. Here's Barlow. Good outside shooter. And Barlow defensed well by McDonald. McDonald, maybe the best defensive player on the floor for the Blue Demons. Woods guarding Henry with a step. Loses the ball. Taken away by Barlow. And there is Jones and a basket and an and-one opportunity for Roosevelt Jones. And has he come on for the Bulldogs?
I tell you what, if you're Billy Garrett, you got to use a little bit more energy on Roosevelt Jones. Good help defense by Butler, which is where their bread is buttered. Right here in transition, if you're Garrett, if you're going at Roosevelt, you've got to wrap him up. You got to foul him much, much harder than that. Roosevelt's too strong, especially when he's coming at you full speed.
Well, Jones missed all of last year with a fractured wrist. And did they miss him? He is the second leading scorer on this team. And he leads in assists. Garrett picking up his first foul. But what a spark he's been.
He's just been that one piece that they've needed to let everyone settle in, play their natural game, play their natural position. He does so many of the little things for this ball club.
Here is Crockett working against Dunham. Off balance. And the rebound taken down by Barlow. Butler by one. Here's Jones. He's tough. Jones lays it in. Roosevelt Jones, the junior from O'Fallon, Illinois, now with five. Schrabis has five, and they've accounted for Butler's points so far. A lot of ball movement with this Blue Demon team.
They've done a really good job early on and not taking quick shots, but right there, they've got to take care of the ball. Butler's been very solid defensively.
Woods! And this crowd gets out of its seat for a slam by Cameron Woods. And the Bulldogs now lead by five. 11-1 at home here at Hinkle for Butler. But 0-3 against DePaul in their history. And another turnover. That's three in a row. And here's Woods again. Leaves it back. And Dunham with a two-point basket. Dunham is a two.
DePaul's going to need a timeout as they get one to settle things down right here. They've got to handle the ball. Just the Butler Ball Club is really scrappy on D. You've got to make multiple passes. You don't get to be in second place in the Big East without being able to defend. Quick hands here by Butler early on, forcing multiple turnovers. Great hard push, and you know Kellen's feeling good when you step back in transition and nail a three.
Chris Holtman has to like what he sees, and Woods with his first points of the game, and the four turnovers by DePaul really putting them in a hole early on. And losing the ball, now a fifth turnover. Four in a row, and here is Jones, and he'll take it himself, put in by Schrabis on the follow. Schrabis, and it's 16-7 now.
Again, the pressure by Butler. They're not known as a team that picks up at half court and pressures you, but when you start to get close to that to scoring range in that three-point line, they really lock in defensively. They've got active hands, and their weak side help is always there.
So now, Butler has run off 11 straight points. Here is McDonald. On the drive, he lost control of it, and Schrabis from behind knocked it away, but the foul will be called on Schrabis, and that'll be his first.
Right here, you're going to see active hands, a lot of bodies all over the place, great defense again by Butler, and then a hard push by Jones.
A blowtorch.
Several people, now he is on the bench. Here's how it happened.
You're going to see Stimmich go up strong, and on the way down, his left hand just comes right across the bridge of the nose of Woods. Good to see, though, that he's on the side, getting his contact put back in. At first, it looked like it was his head, and I was worried about a possible concussion. Good to see
not as groggy as he was before. We expect to see him back in a little bit.
Scary to say the least.
Oh, it really was, because he dropped. He literally dropped after he got hit.
Coming to replace him right now is Austin Etherington, a 6'6 graduate player. He's eligible, transfer from Indiana, number zero, and he's in the game. Meanwhile, the free throw, Stimmage on the line. And that's the first point in 2 minutes and 45 seconds for the Blue Demons.
You know what would be interesting? If DePaul, if they can take care of the ball, especially with Woods out of the middle, look for them to go inside just a little bit and try to take advantage of their size advantage.
And Ron, they have that ability with Stimmage and Tommy Hamilton, the fourth, who is in the game right now. Hamilton was the starter most of the early part of the year until Big East play came around. Travis with a great pass inside. And a foul. Great pass to Dunham from Travis.
Well, that was a set play out of the last break in the game. It's a little action they run. They dribble hard at the corner. And instead of coming around for a handoff, which most defenses are accustomed to getting, it's a hard backdoor cut. Great pass, great finish right there, I thought, by Dunham. Going, giving the defender some body, giving the official something to call.
Stimmage committing the foul, and Kellen Dunham, who is an 85% free throw shooter, leading scorer on the team, and third in the Big East in three-pointers made, have 21 to lead the victory over St. John's, along with seven rebounds on Tuesday. Makes a move. And coming in now will be Tyler Weidman. By the way, Travis leaving the game, having scored seven, and Weidman comes in. He was hit in the face by Chris Obekpa of St. John's in their last game Tuesday. And a flagrant two was called, and Obekpa was disqualified. Derek Wood in the game for DePaul. Knocked away off the chest and another turnover. Good hustle by Butler defensively.
It certainly was. First possession with Woods on the bench. DePaul did just what I expected. They went inside, but again, great hard defense on the dig down, forcing a turnover by Butler.
So Wood is in the game, as is Tommy Hamilton the fourth, trying to take advantage of the depth. A three-pointer by Etherington. Great three-point threat. Broke his foot over the summer, but has recovered. And key off the bench for Chris Holtman. Lead. Garrett defended at the point by Jones, and they'll call the foul on Etherington out on the perimeter.
Travis on the Bulldogs, zero. Austin Etherington is first, third on the team. Yet for the Blue Demons, number four, Mike Henry. Yet for your Bulldogs,
Keelan Martin will come into the game replacing Kellen Dunham, who goes in. Mike Henry returns for DePaul. Dunham scored 4 points. A lot of different combinations of lineups used by Oliver Purnell this year.
And that's part of their plan. They spend a lot of energy on the defensive end. Sometimes they pick up the ball, they meet you at half court, and he likes to use a lot of bodies to try to keep the energy level high.
Derek Wood feeds, and the open jumper drops. Rashawn Stimmage, 6'8 junior from Chicago, and this roster is loaded with the Windy City prep school players who have gone on to play in their home city. You see Holtman going to his bench a lot earlier than usual, and a near steal and a perfect play. Henry keeps it in play, and that is the first turnover against the Bulldogs. 10-point lead for Butler. They try to trap Billy Garrett Jr. And a foul driving was Derek Wood. And the foul called here. Keelan Martin. Timeout is Canole Butler so far here at Hinkley. And here's the New York Life Keep Good Going stat. Butler, 24 straight years with a winning record here in Hinkle Field House, but 0-3 against DePaul, and DePaul has won 6 of the previous 8 games. So for some reason, the Blue Demons, and of course, rosters change, they've had the number of the Bulldogs.
You know, it's interesting. Regardless of how well one team does against another, certain teams just have your number just because of matchups and how the game seems to flow. So far, that advantage has gone to DePaul. But right now, you can tell Butler, they're trying to change that trend desperately.
DePaul shooting 50%. But have taken 4 fewer shots because of the turnovers they've committed.
And if you're Oliver Purnell, you're telling yourself, look here, guys, if we can take care of the ball as another turnover is almost 4.
And it goes back to shape. Henry, Garrett open. He missed the open shot. Etherington has been a factor since coming in. Still have not seen Cameron Woods, who was hit in the face and kind of adjusted his contact lens since he came out of the game. Here's Jones using his body well, Roosevelt Jones, and matching the biggest lead of the game for Butler.
Jones is just so strong that time. He took Garrett Jr. to the block and just muscled his way to the basket.
Tommy Hamilton. Hamilton trying to work his way in, and he does, beating Tyler Weidman, the 6'8 freshman from Sherrillville, Indiana.
I tell you, DePaul has done some really good things offensively when they haven't turned it over. At times, the ball movement has been good. At times, they've thrown it inside and gotten good shots. They just have to take care of the ball. That was a great look, that last possession.
You're right, Ron. These are two well-coached teams, without question. That's why they're the surprises they've been. Martin with a shot. So Keelan Martin, who's a freshman from Louisville, a swing man, has been averaging about 15 minutes a game, and again, a 12-point lead.
I love the upside of Keelan Martin. He's one of those guys, as he progresses in his career, he's going to have a solid career at Butler.
And they rule the possession arrow, and it'll favor DePaul.
And for DePaul, 25,
and now they conferred with the entire committee, and it's going to be Butler ball after initially it was ruled a jump ball when they could not decide who had touched it last. So Barlow coming back in for Butler. And Cameron Woods is in as well. Here's Dunham. And Dunham hits the jumper. Dunham now with 6. And the biggest lead to open up, 14-point advantage.
Last possession, DePaul showed a full-court press. Butler did a great job. 2 passes, broke it, and attacked the pressure to score.
Here's McDonald, defended by Dunham. Good, makes a move to the baseline. Too far into the basket, reverse layup doesn't go. And here are the Bulldogs again. Dunham had the shot, passed it up, hits the 3. Maybe not then, but now.
You can't give him that much space. He came down in transition. He realized that he was a little bit deeper on the floor than he wanted to. Gave a nice little head fake, got in the pocket, pulled up, and let it go. He's making it look real easy.
Dunham now with 9 points hitting his first 3.
Let's go!
You're going to see right here. A lot of active hands, a lot of pressure. The ball goes right out of bounds. No one touches it. Naturally, efficiently, they thought that it was off of a defender, but that possession, DePaul just made a bounce pass and it just went out of bounds.
You can't imagine there being no deflection on that. It was just a pass that went nowhere.
And take a look right here. Dunham coming down the transition. Stops a little bit further than he wanted. Says, you know what, let me get a little bit closer. Puts it on the deck for 1 dribble. Raises and makes it look really, really easy. When he has time and space, one of the best shooters in college basketball.
Kellen Dunham, the junior from Pendleton, Indiana, 9 points on 3-for-4 shooting, including a 3. And there have been 3 three-pointers for Butler and only 1 for DePaul, and that's what they've been banking on most of this year.
And when you play against Butler, they don't allow you to speed them up. And DePaul's success has been geared on their pressure defense, turning guys over, making them play faster than you want. Butler just won't allow you.
And here is Tommy Hamilton hitting the 3, so the big guy can go outside as well. Tommy Hamilton, sophomore from Chicago at 6'11", second 3 of the game for DePaul. And here is the alley-oop, Cameron Woods. Dunham finds it again. Barlow's not been able to get a shot off, and he will lose it out of bounds to DePaul. With 8.5 to go in the first half, the lead is 14.
DePaul went back to their full court pressure. It was a 1-2-2 hard trap initially. They didn't get the steal in the front court, but when they got in half court set, Butler started scrambling, playing just a little bit faster than they wanted to play.
Bulldogs have outscored the Blue Demons 25-6 in the last 7 minutes. And the three missed outside. Turnover, McDonald. Off balance with that shot to Currington. And we'll call a Butler foul. Currington, who rarely plays, a sophomore from Dyer, Indiana, getting a chance to see first half action in his home state.
That last possession, Carrington jumped as though he thought somebody was going to come. If he'd gone strong to the basket, he would have had an easy layup.
Meanwhile, Woods picking up his second person. And Currington on the line for two. R.J. Currington. Blue Demons started the year 3-0 in the Big East and 5-2 at one point. Now they're 6-5 and trying to win a tough road game here in Hinkle. Makes them both 30-18. Pressure. Barlow is fouled. We're going to call it on Jamie Crockett in the timeout.
Last possession, DePaul, they've been picking up the intensity from a defensive standpoint. You're going to see Barlow. He's going to catch it really close to this sideline. He has to be careful. DePaul makes a hard trap. Fortunately, he was able to split it and get through. Ideally, if you're Shravis, you got to work to get open a little bit. Let him pass it over the top, and then Shravis can pass it on, and you can get a fast break transition basket. You see, it's strong. He handled it well enough. But, again, they're coming from behind. When you get trapped, if you turn and face the defense and are able to have an outlet, that's your best bet as opposed to trying to split on two guys.
Ron, how about the Bulldogs hitting 12 of 16 early on and 3 for 3 from three-point range?
Think about the type of shots that they got early. They got a lot of steals. They got some transition baskets. Their confidence got going. And then in the half court, they were taking open jump shots.
Jones misses this off the front rim. McDonald up ahead to Crockett, up fake against Barlow, good feed inside to Henry, but it doesn't drop.
Again, those are shots, if you're Oliver Purnell, you're frustrated that you're missing, but at the same time you're happy you're getting, because those are point blank shots that you've got to think eventually going to fall.
Travis is fouled, driving to the basket on Tommy Hamilton, but you're right, DePaul is executing, they're just not going in. What do coaches say, as your dad used to say, sooner or later they'll drop.
Sooner or later, you gotta hope. But you have to give Butler some credit, because they're physical, they wear on you, and then sometimes you're expecting a body to come, and that body doesn't come.
And there's Woods, and coming over was Henry to help, and he commits the foul. So Mike Henry. And for Henry, that'll be his first personal foul. And Cameron Woods on the free throw line. He is not a good outstanding free throw shooter, although he's improved since Big East play started. On the year, 66%, which isn't that bad. Really.
It's not. It's not the worst in the world. Ideally, I'm sure he'd love to be around that 70-72%, but you'll take what you can get sometimes.
Cameron Woods, who had 18 rebounds against Marquette a week ago, and Butler is up by 13. Biggest lead was 14. Tommy Hamilton, guarded by Woods, will go up for the three. Hit one earlier. Offensive rebound. Too many white shirts underneath. And here's Barlow. DePaul gets back defensively. Dunham in rhythm for three. Second three by Dunham. He's got 12 in the game.
That possession, Barlow just outworked DePaul. That was a 50-50 ball that Barlow came up with, which led to Dunham hitting that three. How many times have we seen today Alex Barlow making defensive stops or being a part of it?
Owning the boards was Woods on Crockett's miss. And here's Dunham from the other side. Another three. His third in a row.
Dunham's going corner to corner so far on the ball. And in transition, you got to try to jam him and make him put the ball on the deck. But right now, it's a little too late because he's feeling it. And credit Butler for finding it.
These guys can't miss. 5 for 5 from three-point range. Opening up a 19-point lead and get it back on another turnover. That's the last thing DePaul needs in this kind of a game. Barlow wins his way through. And the rebound taken down by Hamilton. Currington has it knocked away by Barlow, and the loose ball, Butler has it, taken in, threw it right in the hands of McDonald. McDonald for three. You can't even take a breath here.
You certainly can. And Butler bodies and DePaul bodies are all over the place. It seems like every time a steal is to be had, Barlow's somewhere around the ball.
Boy, Barlow has not been a scorer today, has no points, but boy, he's been a presence now, without question. A playmaker and a defender. They go low and it's knocked away. Good defensive play by Crockett.
Now this is the end where DePaul has to be solid with the ball and get a good look. They can't afford to keep turning it over.
Under 5 to go in the first. It's been all Butler. McDonald in traffic. Traveling. Another turnover against DePaul. That is their 8th here in the first half, and that's got to be driving Oliver Purnell nuts.
Well, what's frustrating about that from a coaching standpoint is you can't establish any rhythm. You can call a play, you can call a set, you can potentially see something that you want to take advantage of, but you can't get into it because of the cost of turnovers. That time DePaul drove, and when you get closer to the basket, especially against Butler, they get really physical. You have to be strong with the ball when you try to attack.
Aaron Simpson in the game for DePaul for the first time, and Martin has his shot deflected. Etherington is there in the right place at the right time. Dunham in traffic. See what Jones does. They're going to call the offensive foul against Roosevelt Jones.
That time, Roosevelt Jones had the free throw line jump shot. Got a little greedy. Tried to get a little bit closer because he's not the most confident player with his jump shot. But he was so open. You got to take that. You got to loosen him up.
They all, Ron, were trying to get a little bit closer, it seemed. That is the 16th foul against Butler. Next foul will put DePaul in the bonus. Forrest Robinson, who started several games, 9 of 11 in the Big East, is in there now. 6'10 senior who can hit from outside. Does it look like DePaul's rushing too much?
It looks like they're waiting for a hit to come by Butler. They're waiting for the physical nature to come, but they just have to be strong with the ball. That was good penetration that time. They got in the gaps, they got in the pocket. Why? Because they were able to make a few passes without turning it over.
Simpson is fouled by Etherington, his second.
Again, you're going to see the hard drive, and the rule is you have to be set if you're the second line of defense before the offensive guy is in the motion of shooting. That time, Butler wasn't quite there.
Aaron Simpson, a junior guard from Chicago. Junior college transfer from Lincoln College in Illinois. So there have been a couple of transfers, junior college people, and of course Mike Henry, who came down from Illinois. 1 out of 2 from the line, and it's 37-19. The ball now in the bonus, and here is Martin hitting. Keelan Martin off the bench, counted on the score from the bench, has his second field goal of the game. 20-point lead. Billy Garrett Jr. back in the lineup. Here's Henry with a jumper, a 3 for Mike Henry.
And that's the area that I really think that Keelan Martin has to get better at, his half-court man-to-man defense. If he gets solid in that aspect, his offensive game takes care of itself.
We'll call Austin Etherington with a travel. Good defense at midcourt, but it's been all Butler. They're up now by 17. We're up by 19. Schedule to your calendar. Tweet hashtag Big East to at Fox Sports 1. And then check your notifications. Big East basketball here at Ingle Fieldhouse. undergoing a great renovation. We'll get more specific as the game goes on. Dunham with 15 leads Butler. And no one on DePaul has more than 5 points. Mike Henry is the leader with 5. Garrett. Guarded by Jackson Aldridge, making his first appearance. 3-point shot missed by Garrett, and they're going to call the DePaul foul. That will be called against Forrest Robinson.
I love the moves by Chris Holtman in terms of extending his bench a little bit. They have a bit of a cushion. They're in a nice rhythm. They're playing well. Just try to establish, you know, a little bit of rhythm with the guys off the bench, because you know as this season progresses, you never know when you have to go deep into your bench, even if it's just for one game to get you to a postseason game.
And we're seeing more of that from Holtman today. Not necessarily because he's had the big lead. When it was closer, he brought in his reserve earlier than usual. Jackson Aldridge, senior from Sydney, Australia, going deep into the bench today. And there is Keelan Martin open for the outside shot. And the rebound taken down by Stimmage. 39-22, 17-point lead. Biggest was 20. Here's Henry with a fake on Martin. Off balance, and the tap-in will go, and I think Stimmage should get credit for it.
Stimmage, number 3.
For John Stimmage, who leads the Big East with 10 block shots. Dunham, shadowed by Garrett. Dunham pushes it up, a 3. Might have forced that one, but Martin is there, and the block inside. Stimmage with the block, so he got the points and the block, and now DePaul trying to see if they can put together consecutive baskets. Setting the screen now is Robinson. Simpson for the 3. Aaron Simpson, who is a 43% shooter from 3-point range. And now it's a 12-point game.
Last two possessions, DePaul, you got good ball movement. You didn't turn it over. You got a good, solid looks at the basket.
And they're going to call the DePaul foul. And Oliver Purnell is off the bench really wondering where that was. The foul is called against.
Again, you're going to see DePaul right here. Nice little pick and roll action. They don't sit on it. They get ball reversal. They get ball movement. Then the clock starts to wind down just a little bit. And Garrett comes off and just swings his set. Shoulder square, Simpson nails it. And if DePaul can get a few more possessions like that in terms of just getting some fluidity to their offense, they'll be in good shape.
And wholesale substitutions in the game. Travis returns in for Butler. And Aldridge making the first free throw. He's averaged about 5.5 minutes of action this year. He's a point guard on the Australian team in the World Basketball Championships 3 years ago. 40-27 the score. Garrett, Stimmage, Simpson, Hamilton, and Henry for DePaul. Under a minute remaining here in the first half. Nick Stockton and Ron Thompson seeing Butler dominate. Here's Simpson. 3-point doesn't go. And here comes Butler. And Keelan Martin. And they're going to call the foul. Keelan Martin called for the charge. His second. And that's the 18th foul. Both teams are in the bonus right now.
That was a great read that time by Garrett. Being the secondary defender, he got outside the circle. His feet were set. And he knew that once Keelan Martin had the ball, his objective, his goal was going to be to get to the rack.
Jackson Davis from Lexington, Kentucky, a freshman, also in action today. Both teams going deep into the bench. Oliver Purnell normally does that. Differential on the clock, very little. The ball would sorely love to get it close to 10 points before intermission. Garrett behind. Stimmich misses the shot. Rebound. And the rebound taken down by Jackson Davis. Timeout called with 2.8 on the clock.
I tell you what, Davis did an awesome job at coming from behind the three-point line to get back in play just to get that rebound. That was excellent second effort for Butler.
Tell you, their bench giving him good contributions, Ron, in this first half.
They really are. And what they've done a good job at is they've watched the four guys. That bench has sat on the side. They've watched the Roosevelt Joneses of the world. They've watched the Alex Barlows. And they've seen how they play. Not just offensively, but defensively. And now we're getting to the latter part of the season. They understand not only how, but why those guys do the things that they've done.
Biggest lead for Butler is 20 points. As the Bulldogs trying to win their fifth in a row and make it 7 out of 8, making a big run here. Right now, they're in undisputed possession of second place in Villanova, beating Georgetown handily. And if Villanova wins, they will go 8-2. And Butler, if they hold on and win, will be still a half a game behind the Wildcats. On the clock. Etherington will inbound. Travis. And a stoppage of the clock. Not sure what the call is here, Ron.
No, not at all. Chris Houghton's like, come on, man. We almost had a clean look at the other end.
Did the clock not start? The ball may have been tipped. So the clock never started. They're going to check the clock. They feel the ball may have been tipped, and the clock never started. So if it was tipped, the clock should have started
right away. And that's what they're going back to look to see if, in fact, it was tipped. And I like the rule. I like the fact that the officials are able to get it right. That particular time, though, if you're Chris Holtman, you're a little frustrated because you're about to get a good look on the other end.
And, you know, the interesting thing is, you know, it's hard to tell on the replay if it was tipped.
It wasn't a clean look.
I mean, if they take that basket away, we'll get a good look, but that's not going to happen.
Not at all. And right now, if you're a Butler, you're happy with the way you executed that last play. And coaches draw up certain plays, and you break from the huddle at times, and guys look at you in the huddle, shake your head, say, I got you, coach. And then you leave, and you get out on the floor, and you're like, what the heck did you just run? That time, Butler executed to perfection.
Well, and so did DePaul, really, when you think they guarded the inbound pass,
yep.
Which is something they didn't always do. Remember, Tate George of Clemson hit a big shot, you know.
Because there was no pressure on the ball.
No pressure on the ball.
That's right.
And you remember Christian Laettner getting the field goal against Kentucky.
That action was very similar to the Christian Laettner basket. That time, Travis started on the baseline, exploded up. The action from the guards in the front court was just a distraction. They threw it right to Travis, and he was wide open.
I believe the play is called home run. Because I remember Jim Calhoun came over. I was working with Hubie Brown at the time. And said, home run, Hubie, home run, when Tate George hit with 1 second to go. So now we have 1.1 on the clock. So it's called home run, and if you don't guard the inbounds passer, it's like a quarterback in a prevent defense. He'll find a receiver.
That's right. And what 1.1, so I like this. The officials, they got it right. The ball was deflected, so I like the ability for these guys to get the call right. So they took some time off the clock, and now they're at half court.
And with 1.1, there's still time.
Yep.
Because Laettner had 1 second to go when he hit his shot. So Etherington now will inbound it at midcourt. Nope. You can't do all that with 1 second to go, and that'll do it. An 8-1 end of the half for DePaul. Butler didn't score in the last, well, nearly 4 minutes to come back here at Hinkle, but they're still behind in this game. 40-27. The score at halftime. Butler leading DePaul. Coming up after the messages, we'll check in with Jill Arrington in the Fox Sports 1 newsroom in Los Angeles.
Number 22, Butler, getting the better of the Blue Demons. Bulldogs up 13 after the first half of play. Welcome inside the Fox Sports 1 newsroom. I'm Jill Arrington with this College Hoops halftime update. We'll get you back out to Hinkle Fieldhouse in Indianapolis shortly. But first, let's check in on some other action from around the nation. A top 10 battle in the ACC. Notre Dame at Duke. Just over 5 minutes left in the first half. Duke up 24. Tyus Jones drives, gets the bucket and the foul. Duke up 26 at the half. Second half, Blue Devils still up 26. Jahlil Okafor with some nice footwork along the baseline. He hits the reverse. Duke up 28. Later in the second, Duke up 27 off the miss. Ooh, Okafor gets the rebound, gathers, and hits the reverse layup, plus the foul. He finished with 20 points. Duke wins by 30. Georgetown at Villanova as seen on Fox. First half, Nova up 13. Darren Hilliard gets the steal. He takes it the other way for the bucket and the foul. Nova led by 14 at the break. Second half, Wildcats still up 14. Dylan Ennis with a great hustle play for the steal. Javon Pinkston finishes with the layup. Villanova wins it 69-53. Marquette at Seton Hall. Second half, Marquette up 7. Juwan Johnson, he feeds Steve Taylor Jr. for the dunk. Golden Eagles up 9. 4.2 seconds left. Seton Hall down 3. Sterling gives with a chance to tie it. Comes up short on the 3. Marquette gets their first road win of the season. Golden Eagles win at 57-54. Creighton St. John's at the Garden. First half, St. John's up 16. Rashid Jordan throwing down the baseline dunk. He finished with a game-high 25 points. St. John's up 22 at the break. Second half, Red Storm up 18. Sir Dominic Poynter rejects James Milliken. Well, then he blocks Devin Brooks at the rim. Now Poynter finished with 8 blocks. St. John wins it 84-66. Coming up, more college hoops for you. Number 6 Arizona travels to Tempe to face in-state rivals Arizona State at the bottom of the hour over on Fox. And after a dramatic win at the buzzer last night, Anthony Davis and the Pelicans look to keep their red-hot streak going when they host the Bulls. Full NBA highlights on Fox Sports Live after Supercross. That's going to do it for us in Los Angeles. We'll get you back out to Dick Stockton and Ron Thompson in Indianapolis for the second half after the break.
Day of activity in the Big East. Earlier today, Xavier beat Providence 78-69, and Hinton with 24 points in defeat. Xavier bench had 53. So as a result, Villanova beating Georgetown. So Villanova now 8-2. Butler is in second place and a chance to move within a half a game if they win. And by winning, Xavier leaped over Seton Hall to go 6-6 and can tie DePaul for the fifth spot if DePaul loses this game.
But if you look in the conference aisle, look at how tightly knit this league is. I mean, you know, everybody's one game away from either going up or going down or dropping two. This league has been an absolute grind.
So right, Ron, the competitiveness, and it's not always the home team either. We're seeing a lot of visiting teams come through as we get underway. Let's see what DePaul does with Crockett, Henry, Garrett, of course, at the point, Stimmage, and Simpson starting the second half, misses outside, but we'll have a Butler foul. And Travis battling for the loose ball, and that will be his second.
Roosevelt Jones really hadn't scored an awful lot this game, but I tell you what he's done a really, really good job defensively on Billy Garrett. Billy Garrett hasn't been able to get on a roll himself, and that's huge for DePaul, especially when they're on the road.
Stimmich with six is the leading scorer, also has four rebounds to lead the way. Stimmich making his third straight start, the junior from Chicago. Henry at the point right now. Remember, it was a 20-point lead at 39-19. Here's Simpson. Crockett from the corner hits the three. So now 10 points have been shaved off the biggest lead for Butler, and we haven't even played a minute here in the second half.
One thing for certain, you had to know coming into this game that Oliver Purnell's ball club, they weren't going to just go away. All season long, they've been grinding it out, having competitive games. This is not the same DePaul Blue Demon ball club that we've seen in the past.
Travis gets inside. That's the way he started the game, didn't he?
Look, and credit Chris Holtman for realizing that. They said, you know what? Travis did an excellent job early on getting us going. Let's go back to him to start the second half.
9 points for Travis. Cameron Woods on the defense, and Henry can't convert the layup. And there is Roosevelt Jones out of control. Barlow has the open shot for three, and hits. So Barlow has six assists, gets his first points of the game, and the lead is 15. And Garrett is shaken up. Billy Garrett Jr. will try to walk this thing off, and it may not be that easy as he now has to be helped.
On the hard drive, he, as well as Roosevelt Jones, they collided right here. And you see maybe a little knee action got a little tangled up, and you hate to see someone go down, but hopefully he can shake it off.
Boy, that's a tough guy to be in front of when he's driving.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Roosevelt Jones is a load when he's coming full steam ahead.
Billy Garrett Sr. is the coach, and of course there's some history here with the Garrett family in the state of Indiana. Shelbyville, to be precise. Bill Garrett, a legend, Indiana State High School championship figure. This is one of the golden states of basketball, and has for years, along with Kentucky and Indiana.
The Garretts have 65 family and friends here at the game tonight. They're all giving a collective sigh as Billy Garrett Jr. goes over there and tries to shake off this injury.
Darrell McDonald will replace Garrett. Crockett. Crockett on the drive. Foul. Hey, this is a quick DePaul team, and if they get a step, they can beat you off the dribble.
And that's, I'm looking at Oliver Purnell right now, looking at his guys, saying, look, that's all we have to do. Take care of the ball and drive it. Drive it hard. And they've been able to get solid looks at the start of the second half. And if they can continue to do that, they'll crawl deep. They'll really crawl back into this game.
No question. Dunham committing his first foul, and Jamie Crockett, who led DePaul in their win over Seton Hall Tuesday with 21 points, the fourth time in his career he's gone over 20. He was injured last year, played only 19 games, but the third leading scorer coming in today for the Blue Demons, and he hits the boat. So it's down again to 13.
Crockett is one of the many weapons that DePaul has. They have a lot of guys on this roster that can just flat out go and get their own shot. If they can lock up defensively, that's where their Achilles heel has been at times.
Yes, and it has been. Always good perimeter team, but they have only 4 3-point baskets in the first half. Crockett has one in the second. Roosevelt Jones trying to get ahead of steam. Gives up the dribble. 9 on the shot clock now. Travis is posting up, and they're going to call the pushing foul inside and against the Blue Demons. And the foul will be against Crockett, his second.
I tell you, this is a really, really experienced Butler ball club. The shot clock was starting to wind down a little bit. Excellent move by Dunham to put the ball on the deck and drive. And if DePaul doesn't stop you, you have a layup. That time they fouled it.
Jones wants the ball inside, being overplayed a bit by McDonald, has size and heft advantage on him. Now, here's Dunham. He'll give Travis the outside shot. Got to watch that. He'll hit him. And driving to the baseline is Dunham, and he's fouled. So, DePaul with the foul. And Crockett now has picked up his third foul. And going to the bench And Billy Garrett Jr., who had to come out a few moments ago, back his left knee, is coming back in, replacing Crockett, who goes out with three. Garrett, by the way, only 2 points so far in the game. Two assists, and Travis draws the foul. So it was the turnovers early in the first half for DePaul then, now the foul.
And as we come down the stretch of this game, Butler, they're not the best free throw shooting team in the world. So the strategy may not be the worst thing in the world for DePaul, but it's going to be key. Butler, they've got to come up, knuckle up, and just nail these things.
Butler is ninth going in free throw shooting. McDonald picked up the personal foul. Butler trying to make a five-game winning streak and solidify second place. They won't have to share it with Providence losing to Xavier early. Henry directing traffic. They loop it in to Hamilton. And he does not convert the layup. Had good position.
Great position. If you're Hamilton, you have to finish that because you're not going to get a closer look or a closer attempt to the basket than that.
Dunham driving and no basket. No basket. The foul before the shot. And it's on Billy Garrett.
Foul on the Pauls, number four.
Make it Mike Henry. It'll be second on Henry.
Again, after ball movement, you're getting a lot of aggressive drives by both ball clubs, which is very wise, I think. Sometimes I think too many teams settle for jump shots. Neither one of these teams are shooting an abundance of jumpers.
Good pass inside to Travis. Travis using his body, and the basket counts in the foul. Tommy Hamilton did everything he could do inside.
He certainly did. He just got hit with an awesome offensive move, that possession by Travis. He stole baseline, came back to the middle. This is just a great one-on-one move. Tried to go baseline, saw it was cut off, came back middle, took the bump, and finished with the right-hand jump hook. That's just good offensive basketball.
Second foul on Hamilton, already five team fouls on DePaul, and the and one by Travis, who now has 14 points. And Dunham with 15, leading scorers in the game. And once again, they're up to an 18-point bulge.
Every time DePaul has tried to make a run, Butler has had an answer for it to extend this lead.
Forrest Robinson has checked into the game. Butler is not letting DePaul get inside at all here.
Well, that's where their defense is structured. It's called like a pack line defense. You may beat the first guy, but the second and third guy, you better bet it's going to be there.
Simpson, no basket, and the foul before the shot by Simpson. And the personal foul is on Barlow. 13 foul on Butler. But right now, DePaul's just treading water. They're not making much inroad, and the basket will count. And McDonald, Darrell McDonald, on a great pass for the field goal and the personal foul. Barlow picks up two in a row there, Ron.
Nice little ball fake away from the initial pass by Billy Garrett. He looked to the left and then hit a streaking McDonald coming down the middle. Ball fakes, that's one of those things, like a shot fake that's underused. The ball fake is one of another one. Great job by Billy Garrett.
More of a subtle way you've seen the shot fakes. And he cannot convert the three-point deal. McDonald misses. Haven't been many misses or many trips to the line for either team in this game. That was only the second miss from the line for DePaul in about eight tries. Travis. And near tie-up, and the foul. Nearly the block for Stimmage. Instead, he commits the foul on Travis. Timeout, it's 50-34, Butler. Mental disorder. And that is why the college basketball community is teaming up with Autism Speaks to raise funds and awareness this weekend. And you can, too. Participate in Coaches Powering Forward for Autism. Visit autismspeaks.org/coachpower. There you see the pins worn by the coaches today. And those of us at the table as well, Ron Thompson.
Anthony Blue, defense 21, Jamie Crockett.
Jamie Crockett coming back into the game for DePaul. Schrabbes is on the line. 14 points for Schrabbes, and you mentioned his 30-point career high against Marquette a week ago with 8 rebounds.
He's really versatile. He's a matchup problem a lot of times for a lot of bigs. With his 6'7 frame, he can step out and shoot it, but he can handle it well enough to get the spots on the floor. He doesn't overdo it. And on the block, he has counters to his moves.
Sophomore from Portsmouth, Rhode Island, misses both free throws. Began to start toward the end of last season and has now been a force. So let's see what DePaul, down by 16. Got it down to 10 a few moments ago. Forrest Robinson hitting the shot. How smooth was that Forrest Robinson?
It was tough. And that's the thing about this DePaul ball club is they have a lot of guys that can score. They can put it on the floor. They can shoot it. If they can lock up and get some stops defensively, they have enough firepower offensively.
Jones loses the ball in a turnover. Meanwhile, Robinson leads the team in three-pointers made at 6'10". He's a senior. So now, for a few times, DePaul getting a chance to take advantage of a turnover. And here is Stimmich driving in. Nicely done. Rashawn Stimmich, undeterred, going baseline. And Stimmich now with 8. Five minutes gone by here in the second half. Dick Stockton, Ron Thompson here at Hinkle Fieldhouse, where the Bulldogs have won 11 of 12. Here's Cameron Woods, defended by Robinson, and they're going to call Robinson with the push.
Again, so far, DePaul's done a good job of getting ball movement. That time, Robinson comes off the high ball screen for the nice jump shot and Stimmich. If you allow him to get that close, he's too athletic for Schrabbes to guard.
And the bonus time for Butler, that's the 7th team foul. And Cameron Woods on the line. Woods, the leading rebounder in the Big East. Top defensive rebounder and second offensive off the glass. And that is 1 out of 2. He has 4 points, but he's done a great job off the boards. And now they said it is going to be the DePaul ball off the foot of Schrabbes. Well, it's a 13-point game, and DePaul, which has 4 3-pointers, 5 in the game, they can get back in a hurry by hitting downtown. But I know you want to work it inside.
Yep, that's the ideal thing for them. They want to try to get it inside if they can. But again, when you have ball movement and patience with the shooters that DePaul has on this ball club, if you're Butler, you can't lose sight of, even though they're big, those bigs can hit those jump shots.
Forrest Robinson with the 3. And now they're down to 10. Remember, 20-point lead at 39-19 with 3:57 to go in the first half. The ball out of bounds. DePaul back. Still a lot of time, and the Blue Demons are putting on a push and going to the bench and bringing back Roosevelt Jones will be Chris Holmes.
And you said it during the break that DePaul's got one more push at least in their blood, and they're making it right now. They can score this possession. They can get this thing to single digits, and that totally changes the complexion of the game. Let's see if Butler can either get a stop or if DePaul, if they can get a solid look this possession.
Tyler Weidman, the freshman, coming back in as well. And this is the closest the Blue Demons have been since the score was 18-9 in the first half early on. Crowd is quiet at 2. Blue Demons have taken the crowd out of it, but they continue. Crockett, nowhere to go with it. Elon Martin also in the game. A lot of bulk for Butler. Here's Billy Garrett, Jr. Garrett has it blocked. Loose ball, and coming out of the pack, McDonald, Crockett misses the 3, but now at the other end they're going to call a push-off against DePaul as Roosevelt Jones hits the floor.
And that's a really good call. Garrett tried to get away with it. I thought that Roosevelt Jones sold it a little bit, but Garrett definitely pushed him. Great defense both ways. That time, the hard push by Butler. Paul, they didn't give up on the play. They came hard from behind and went back at him. This DePaul Blue Demon team, if you watch them play over the last 3 or 4 years, around this point in time in the game,
you know, expect Butler to go on a run and to get them out of here. But this Duke Blue Demon Ball Club, they've showed a lot of grit this season. They've showed a lot of intestinal fortitude. That's why right now, so far in the league, they've caused so much havoc.
Now, he didn't sell it like Sir Dominic Poynter did, did he?
No. Sir Dominic Poynter jumped out of bounds.
That was the weirdest thing I'd seen.
It was funny when you watched it.
Yeah, I watched that. Really. You know, it was crazy. So Jones now with 8 points in the game. Crockett has three fouls. Stimmich and Henry, Robinson and Hamilton all with two. Garrett two as well. 12-point lead. Oodles of time remaining. McDonald, Simpson, Morris Robinson, and McDonald with a drive. Pretty play, McDonald making a great drive against Weidman. And it's now down to 10 again, trying to get it to single digits somehow.
Poor communication that time by Butler, and credit McDonald for taking advantage. They were in a pick-and-roll situation. Butler didn't talk.
You mentioned DePaul. Defense has not been their strong suit. Let's see how they respond defensively here. Here is Barlow. Great play by Barlow. Just walked that one in. To 45-43. Forrest Robinson hitting the three. Robinson with his second three here in the second half.
Now this is this side of the court where DePaul has to make sure that their numbers stay in front of their offensive guys. You can't give them angles. You can't let them turn corners.
And they're under double digits. And they're going to call the foul against DePaul going the other way. So they get on Henry. No, that's not right. It's not. It's on Weidman. And DePaul down by nine. And there's Weidman on the bench right now.
Assistant coach Terry Johnson telling them, look here, we didn't need that right then and there. Just let that go. You don't want to get a foul 30 feet away from the ball.
And Robinson is fouled by Schrabis. So Schrabis with his third foul. And the 16th foul.
A little mix up here defensively by Butler. McDonald takes advantage of it and gets all the way to the rack. And then they go down the other end. Good ball movement. With the shooters the ball DePaul has, they make it look easy.
Getting closer.
Not playing hard enough right now. Not always playing smart enough either. Gotta play harder and smarter. Understand? Harder and smarter. Right now.
You've got to love that, and I like the directness that you saw from Coach Holtman that time in the huddle. He's telling his guys, look, in the first half, we really got after it. Defensively, we chucked cutters, we made it difficult for them to score. Right now in the second half, DePaul offensively has gotten whatever they wanted.
Going into the game, we knew that DePaul had the deeper bench. They have outscored Butler off the bench 19-8. And Forrest Robinson, ball going out of bounds, missing from outside, so they have an 11-point edge with their bench, which is their strong suit, especially against this team.
And right now, Butler, they have to give a little special attention to Forrest Robinson. He has it going a little bit. Coming into the game, he's taken 132 shots. 102 of them have been from behind the arc. So that's telling you what he's looking to do.
Woods back in. Travis playing with three fouls. He has the ball down low. Barlow. And the tip doesn't go. Tip attempt missed by Martin. Crockett with the up fake and not going for it is Martin. Trying to cut it now to seventh or even sixth. Butler had a 20-point lead in the first half. And here is Crockett. This is the layup. So an opportunity goes by the boards on that position. Woods low. Big size advantage on McDonald. Trying to use it, but can't. Donald 6'1". Woods at 6'9". And the layup by Simpson, and now it's down to 7, 55-48.
Right now, DePaul is doing a really good job at forcing Butler to chase them. On missed baskets, they push it. Then once they push it, they're running through their sets in the half court, and Butler's having difficulty getting their half court defense set up.
Two big men setting a screen on top here as Travis going up and comes down in the hands of McDonald to a driving Crockett, and we may see another timeout now. 55-50, halfway through the second half. No timeout is called, and now they do. Timeout called, and a big run for DePaul. They were down by 20. It's now a five-point game.
We're going to see right here the one few of the fast break opportunities we've seen by the DePaul Blue Demons. They're getting stops, they're getting rebounds, and they're getting out in transition.
And welcome back to Big East College Hoops on Fox Sports 1, presented by New York Life. DePaul has scored the last 7 points, Ron. Why?
Because of Mr. Robinson. He's been doing a great job at hovering around that three-point line. And if you're Butler, you've got to make the adjustment. Even though he's 6'10", 6'11", he likes to stand outside that three-point arc. And it goes against your natural inclination as a defender in terms of guarding a big. As you see, the Butler defenders are a little bit late because they're not accustomed to chasing centers and power forwards outside that three-point arc. And he's done an excellent job, that's Lawrence Robinson, at knocking down those looks, getting the ball back in it.
Lawrence Robinson, a senior from Ranger, Texas, transferred from North Texas after the 2012 season. And he leads the team in three-pointers made, has started 9 of 12 Big East games, making a contribution here. And they're going to call the foul on Aaron Simpson.
Oliver Pennell has done a great job in this second half at getting these guys to lock in defensively. The first half, Butler, they shot over 60%. Right now, they've shored up their defense, and when Butler shoots and misses, they're making sure they're one and done. DePaul's getting stops, getting the rebound, and then getting out, forcing Butler to chase them a little bit on the offensive end.
Kellen Dunham is looking for his 17th point. He's the high scorer in the game. Travis has 14. And still, there are no players in double figures for DePaul. Down now by 7. Garrett picked up by Travis on the switch. Crockett with a 3. Crockett now makes it 4-point game, 57-53. Crockett now with 10 becomes the first double-figure scorer for the Blue Demons. This crowd is dead silent here at Hinkle Fieldhouse. Jones, though, will get it going again.
And that's the beauty of having a senior, a junior like Roosevelt Jones, an upperclassman that knows when your team needs a bucket and knows how to go and get it.
Right now, DePaul very, very much in this game with just under 9 minutes remaining. After being down by 20, here's Henry, doesn't go, and they're going to call the foul on Butler inside.
Again, you're going to see a nice little pick and roll action here by Garrett. Garrett gets ball reversal. Again, because of the ball movement and the action that you're seeing by DePaul, they're forcing Butler to be in a situation where they're chasing them a little bit, which is getting DePaul some open looks.
And Ron, Cameron Woods picking up his third personal foul. So he and Travis have 3 fouls. Stimmich hitting the free throw.
When you're on the road, if your team can hit some free throws, some easy shots to keep, either get you, inch you back in the game, or if you have a lead to extend it, it goes a long way.
He had 8 points and 7 rebounds and 3 blocks in the win over Seton Hall. Has come up with another solid game at both ends. Coming into the game, Austin Etherington, who made a contribution in the first half with 3 points and 3 boards, and replacing Woods, who goes to the bench with 3 fouls. 4-point game, Butler ball. Dunham guarded by Simpson, goes for the 3 and hits. Kellen Dunham with his 4th three-pointer of the game has 20 now.
Remember I told you in the Open that with his 6'6 frame, if you don't jam him and he raises, he's not looking at you. You got to get up under Dunham and get a hand up.
He goes vertical.
Yep.
And missing from the corner there was Henry, but it's retained by Crockett. Crockett can't convert, and a foul inside against Butler, and it's going to be Austin Etherington with the personal foul. He has three.
Right now, you're going to see Aaron Simpson. He is not up under Kellen Dunham. You can't be that far away and allow someone 6'6 and you're 5'11. You've got to jam him, make him put the ball on the floor.
So Mike Henry on the free throw line. Top offensive rebounder. And he showed it there when he got fouled on the miss.
One and one.
It is not the double bonus, and it wasn't in the act of shooting. Darrell McDonald will check in for Aaron Simpson now.
Now that DePaul, they're in the one-and-one situation, the game changes for them especially. If they can take care of the ball and get some action going towards the basket, every time they're fouled, they're shooting. So now you're able to get easy points with the clock stopped and get back in this thing and potentially take the lead.
Henry looking for his 7th point of the game, came in second on the team at nearly 13 points a contest. And it's a 5-point lead for Butler. 8:10 to go in the second half. Butler trying to make it 5 straight and 7 out of 8. Here's the drive by Kellum Dunham, and he's fouled. Well done by Dunham.
It certainly was. Again, he had the angle and took advantage of it, got to a spot, just jumped over his defender.
Timeout. Natalie Marquette, it all begins Tuesday at 7 p.m. Eastern on Fox Sports 1 and streaming live on Fox Sports Go. Now, Ron, I know your dad, the great John Thompson, not in a good mood right now after Villanova beat Georgetown. I know he didn't have a chance to watch your work in the first half. He's watching it now, and I have to say, it's got to be brighter without question.
Let me tell you, he cringes every time my brother's team plays. I mean, you would think that he's still coaching. He goes to all the practices. He goes to all the home games. He goes to some of the road games. And it's like he's having an ulcer on his side. He's just cringing like, Pop, relax. Your time is over. Let John take it from here on out.
You can tell him you're wasting your breath.
You're so right. You're so right about that.
Well, you've got a good one sitting next to me, I'll tell you that.
I appreciate it. I'm sitting next to the legend. I'm just when I found that I was doing the game with you, I had to look at my email twice.
And then you called up and said, can I get out of this game?
No.
It's been a lot of fun. Anyway, Dunham, who has made 17 of his 18 free throws, and now 18 out of 19. Coming back into the game is Cameron Woods. Now Woods is playing with 3 fouls, no one in 4. Travis goes to the bench. He has scored 14 in the game. Checking in for DePaul is Forrest Robinson. Now he was a spark when he's in there. Stimmich sits down. Billy Garrett Jr. running the show for the Blue Demons. 7-point game. They had it down to 4 after trailing by 20 in the first half. And the drive by Crockett. Crockett with the drive. What a first step for the senior from Chicago, Jamie Crockett.
You know what's happening now? Because Butler knows that if they foul, they're putting DePaul on the free throw line. Their defense is just a little bit looser now. So DePaul, if you can take care of the ball and keep attacking the basket, you're going to get a foul or you're going to get a wide open layup.
Pass inside. And Jones gets the basket. Roosevelt Jones cannot be held down for long. 13 points. And a chance for the and one here.
He's just bigger, wider, and stronger than all the DePaul guards. And credit Butler for being methodical, for picking DePaul apart, finding the mismatch, and then taking advantage of it.
Garrett picking up his 3rd foul. And Jones, who is a perfect 3-for-3 from the line, makes the 3-point play. And now Butler is up by 8.
If I'm Butler, I look to come back to that action just a little bit more, because there's no way that Garrett or McDonald can defend Roosevelt Jones along that baseline.
See Chris Holtman on the sideline urging his team on. Don't take your foot off the pedal now. Forrest Robinson way off with the three-point try.
And that's just a bad shot by Robinson. But DePaul has had good success at moving the ball. Not many passes were made. They've had good success at driving, getting to the basket. That was just a forced bad shot.
And too early in the clock.
Way too early.
Here's Jones again. Yep. Foul. No traveling called against Roosevelt Jones.
But the action is good. He scored on one block. Chris Holtman says, you know what? I see the advantage. I see what we can take advantage of. They come back to him on the opposite block.
I was going to say they're following your recipe. And they, by the way, you're right. He did get the ball in good position down low.
And when you have a guy like Roosevelt Jones, from a coaching perspective, he's a joy because you can put him anywhere on the floor and he's comfortable.
Ball's had an uphill climb throughout this game. Not easy to be on the road and have to climb that mountain so many times.
Especially against an experienced veteran ball club like Butler.
Billy Carrot Jr. Here's Crockett for three. And a whistle. And it'll be a Butler foul underneath, away from the ball. And Roosevelt Jones, his second. So we have the double bonus to the benefit of Butler, and that is the 19th foul against Butler. So DePaul one foul away from that as Aaron Simpson comes back in. Billy Garrett sitting down. So here is Forrest Robinson.
If you're DePaul right now, the scouting report of Butler becomes huge. You have to know personnel. You have to know who you're guarding, what their tendencies are. You know a guy like Dunham, he likes to shoot jump shots. You've got to jam him. You've got a guy like Roosevelt Jones. He's not going to take many. If he has an angle, he's going to try to get to the basket, so the weak side help has to be there.
Missed free throw, one out of two. So it remains a seven-point Butler lead. Dunham. Here's Barlow. Open for three, and he's got it. Alex Barlow, who's named All-Academic District 5 team this week, he's the Big East Scholar of the Year for men's basketball, has the brains and the shooting ability, apparently. And now the 10-point lead, double digits again, and the turnover. Robinson loses it to Barlow. Dunham for three. And the fight inside, and it's last touched by DePaul, so Butler will maintain the ball.
You're going to see right here, hard push by Dunham. DePaul, you've got to keep the numbers in front of your defender, and then you form a walk-on. He's sitting outside the three-point line, taking target practice. That time, a defensive breakdown by DePaul. Their inability to stay in front of drivers caused the big help to come, which gave Barlow the wide-open jump shot in the corner.
Stimmage and Garrett return for DePaul. 5.5 remaining in the second half. The lead is 10. And good position for Henry to get the board. Garrett puts up the three. And too many missed threes for DePaul when they had cut it to four. Here's the loop, the alley-oop. Woods from Jones. Big basket.
Again, Butler just making plays, and DePaul not making it any easier. Settling for too many early jump shots. The layups were going good. They were getting to the basket. Then they started taking jump shots. Butler, they're too solid, too experienced. They've locked up defensively, and they're taking advantage of it on the offensive end.
They brought the crowd back into this one.
They certainly did. Good hard push here by Roosevelt Jones. Woods with those long arms and that 6'9 athletic frame. They throw it up there. They convert in transition again. DePaul made their push, and then now Butler tightens things up, and they get out.
Well, next Saturday, regular season title races heat up in a doubleheader on Fox. First, D'Angelo Harrison looks to be the spark as St. John's take on Xavier. And Joseph Young leads the charge for Oregon against UCLA. A College Hoops doubleheader tipped off next Saturday at noon Eastern on Fox and streaming live on Fox Sports Go. Once again, the Big East standings, and Ron Thompson talking about how competitive it, battling it was for all these teams. Even St. John's 4-6, they're battling, and they won today. Villanova has the lead. They won today. Butler trying to solidify second place all alone. Providence lost to Xavier today. And Xavier vaulted over Seton Hall and can tie DePaul for fifth place if DePaul goes down in this one. Meanwhile, Butler, in the last 2.5 minutes, have outscored DePaul 8-1. And what was a four-point game, now a little breathing room run.
You know, and they did it by, you know, not getting rattled. You know, I looked at the faces of the Butler Bulldogs when DePaul made that run, and they didn't start bickering, they didn't start pointing fingers. They just locked up, stuck to the plan, and tightened things up on the defensive end.
Garrett looking inside. Butler cutting it off. Tipped out of bounds. Last touch by Butler. Plenty of time on the shot clock. So a 20-point lead was winnowed down to 4 before Butler, taking advantage of some missed threes and some cool-headed play, raised it up again to 12.
And that was an example of DePaul not understanding how they got the lead, as you
like
see.
That.
Exactly, as you see a tighter curl, some action going towards the basket by Crockett.
Crockett with 14 points, leading scorer for DePaul, now down by 10. Crockett did not score in the first half. All 14 here in the second. Jones scoops it up, and another and one. He's had them all day.
Well, it's not always how many points you score, but when you get those buckets. And DePaul made their run, and then what happened? A guy like Jones starts to take over, either passing the ball, getting to the basket, making some layups. And that was not an accident. He makes unorthodox shots. And earlier, we were out here before the game, Butler had a session, about an 8-minute session, where everyone was just practicing different kinds of layups. In this era of basketball where everyone either wants to shoot a deep three or dunk it, they were running to the basket, shooting layups, shooting floaters, jumping off the wrong foot, because they know that that is how they have to be able to score.
Great points and different styles in getting those layups, as you pointed out. 16 points for Jones. Meanwhile, Mike Henry has 4 fouls. And he remains in the game. This time Butler committing a foul. And now both teams have been in the double bonus.
And if you noticed after that timeout, DePaul's action now is starting to gravitate to going back towards the basket. Oliver Pennell got his guys to refocus, get away from that three-point line, start driving again.
How easy it is to settle.
It's really easy, because a jump shot in the game of basketball is the easiest shot to get. It's not the easiest shot to make. You know, but you know, a lot of times the pressure defense doesn't ride you outside behind that three-point arc. You figure, you know what, I got some time, I got some space, let me take the shot. But it takes more discipline to try and get layups, which is a harder shot to get, but it's easier to make if you can get there.
Got to work a little bit to get the layups.
Yeah, you got to work a whole lot to get layups.
Billy Garrett, with only 3 points in the game, misses the free throw. DePaul needs every opportunity they can with nearly 4 minutes remaining. It's an 11-point lead for Butler, 74-63. DePaul has made a run. The question is, can they make another one now? And we'll get the ball back on a turnover. And checking in, Darrell McDonald. And he'll replace Simpson. Crockett with 14. Stimmage has 10. Robinson 9 are the leading scorers for DePaul. Driving to the basket, baseline style, and the basket for Henry. Playing with 4 fouls, Mike Henry cuts it to 9. Full court pressure. DePaul has only 1 timeout remaining, and they're going to call the DePaul foul. Jones is fouled and will go to the line when we come back here with 3:35 to go. Butler trying to close out the Blue Demons. Butler by 9, and we know Kellen Dunham is their big scorer, but we know how much Roosevelt Jones has added to this team.
Well, he's one of the best closers in college basketball. As we wind down this game, everything's going through him. He's putting the ball on the deck, making plays, he's posting up the ball, and then he realizes when it's his time. And that's even more important than his ability to do it, is understanding that, look here, I'm an upperclassman, this team needs me. DePaul's making a run. Let me get him out of here.
Butler is shooting 58% from the field. In the win over St. John's, they shot 56%. The first time they were over 50% shooting in Big East play. So now it's two straight games they've been able to do it, unless they really go ice cold the rest of the way. And here is Jones. Only 57% from the line, but makes that one. Roosevelt Jones, this last year with a broken wrist, leads the team in assists, second leading scorer, can score from anywhere. And the junior from O'Fallon, Illinois, just tough to stop.
He really is. He's so, so skilled. You look at him. As you see Stravis coming over from the weak side, getting a big time block. Even he had to smile a little bit. You know, understanding that's not usually what I do, but if my team needs it, I'm right here for you. Nice weak side help. Stravis says, get that mess out of here.
Boy, he's been a colorful active player.
And he's been playing this way and this well for the last five or six games or so. He's upped his scoring the last five games. You know, and he does an awful lot. And when you're on the floor, you know, as a sophomore playing with a lot of veterans, your job becomes a lot easier.
Simpson with the scoop doesn't work. Woods with the rebound. Winding to 3 minutes remaining. And an 11-point Butler lead. Bulldogs trying to make it 8-3 in Big East play and go to 18-6 on the season. Their RPI is 18th, ranked 22nd nationally, and showing why today. Jones with the drive to the hoop. And the rebound by Henry. DePaul needs points, and they need it in a hurry. And they need stops. Foul. And Henry will go to the line. No, that's not Henry. That's Billy Garrett will shoot two. And Jones with his foul. Three on him. The only player in the game with four personal fouls is Mike Henry.
Billy Garrett, DePaul's leading scorer, has been held in check today by Butler. You know, you have to give the Butler defense and scouting report an awful lot of credit for being all over Garrett, making sure he hasn't been able to hit a rhythm this game.
Only one field goal, Ron, for Billy Garrett. Checking in will be Darrell McDonald in a moment. And the free throws. So McDonald will come in and Garrett will go out. Garrett with 5 points today. Jones. Dunham. And Cameron Woods with position and a jump ball. The possession arrow will favor Butler.
Big time rebound by Jones that time. I thought it was a really quick shot, that possession by Dunham, but Woods all over the boards that time, going up strong on the weak side.
So offensive, defensive substitutions going on here. Garrett back in the game. Sat down for a moment.
If you're Butler, you have to know right now, especially as we're approaching 2 minutes to go in the game, DePaul's going to be overly aggressive on the defensive end, and they have to make sure they meet passes.
They need passes, they need stops, they need threes. Dunham. Travis handled the tough pass inside. Turnaround and the basket. Travis with the basket continues to shine for Butler. 16 points. One of three in double figures. Jones with 18 and Dunham the leading scorer with 22. No surprise there. And here is McDonald with the scoop play and he's fouled. And will go to the line. Darrell McDonald. Fouls against Jones and that will be his fourth.
when DePaul goes back and they watch the film of this game, especially collectively, they're going to want to know, why didn't we drive and attack the basket a little bit more, especially earlier in this game? Because they've had an awful lot of success here in the second half at just attacking Butler off the dribble.
And, you know, the turnovers in the first half, that put them in a big hole, Ron.
And not just the fact that they turned it over and then gave up a layup. If you looked at the turnovers at halftime, DePaul had 9, Butler had 8. But the difference was DePaul gave up baskets when they had their turnovers.
Pressure, full court, and Crockett fouls Jones, and they've got no choice right now. 9-point lead and trying to get it into double digits once again. And Jones going to the free throw line.
Jones is like a really good wide receiver. You know, when the quarterback drops back in, the pattern that you run is defended. The wide receiver has to come back. He has to really work to get open. Roosevelt Jones gets his hands on the ball because he fights and works to get open. He doesn't shy away from the fact that the ball is pressuring him.
Almost that he invites it.
He loves it. He loves it because he knows he's comfortable at handling the ball off the bounce, and he can catch the ball. He has strong hands.
Still a 9-point game. Here's Billy Garrett Jr. He's way off the mark. Only one field goal for Billy Garrett, the heart and soul of this DePaul team, and only a sophomore. And time running out on the DePaul Blue Demons. They broke a 3-game losing streak in beating Seton Hall this week. And the foul on Crockett. DePaul lost 6 in a row heading into the Big East season after winning 6 of their first 7 games. They started out 3-0, 5-2, and will go 6-6 in Big East play. And Jamie Crockett fouls out of the game after scoring 14 points.
I tell you what, Oliver Purnell is not going to be excited about this loss if things continue this way. But his ball club has really, really fought. He's turned the corner. He's in his 5th season. He took over a program that was at ground zero. And it takes time to get all your troops in line, all your ducks in a row, to get the team, the school, the administration to understand your philosophy. These guys are starting to turn this corner. They play really, really hard. And we heard Coach Holtman saying in the huddle, look, he said, guys, you're playing a good basketball team. We have to grit our teeth if we're going to come out here with a win, and that's exactly what they did.
They got good talent waiting in the wings as well. This is a team that has finished last in the Big East 4 straight years. They've got St. John's on the road Wednesday, home to Providence a week later. Then they are at Georgetown, home with Creighton, and then the rematch with Butler.
And no one is looking at DePaul as their exhale game, which used to be the case. You're not looking at DePaul saying, oh, we have this win. You've got to play.
There's great upside to them. McDonald misses. Still DePaul ball. McDonald again. And traveling call. So Butler, with an 80-69 lead at 103 to go, will finally defeat the DePaul Blue Demons here at Hinkle Fieldhouse. They will go 12-1 at home, and shaken up is McDonald.
You're going to see a collision. McDonald trying to get a little closer to the basket, and just right there, boom. Head-on-head collision. Both guys a little groggy right now. When Butler gets a lead on you, they're one of the best teams that I've seen in the Big East at closing the game. They don't allow you to get back in it. They control the pace and tempo with their offense. But defensively, they control the pace and tempo as well, because even though they don't extend their defense to full court, in the half court, they do a lot of different things. You know, you look at them, you see them playing man-to-man. But when you dive into it, they're doing a lot of little different things out of it. Sometimes on ball screens, they'll trap. Sometimes they'll show big. Sometimes they'll just fight through. Sometimes they'll switch everything on the court with all 5 positions. So they really do a good job at getting you out of your rhythm defensively and offensively.
Last year, Butler was 14-17 on the year, 4-14 in the Big East. DePaul won 3. That's why these, certainly the 2 surprise teams in the conference this year. And Butler will go to 8-3 and trail Villanova by a half a game in second place. Chris Holtman, no longer the interim coach, the full-time guy. And it looks like he wants to be here for a while.
Oh, I mean, and it's well-deserved. He did an outstanding job in a difficult situation, taking over, you know, just at the start of the season. You know, and he did a really good job. I spoke with him, and he said, you know what? He said, I didn't try to reinvent the wheel. I didn't change everything. I wanted to keep a lot of what was going on. Because you don't want the guys to start over when you take over a program at the last minute.
Travis with 16 points going to the bench. And Woods with the free throw. And under a minute remaining, 81-69. Butler built up a 20-point lead during the first half. Will have a foul as Garrett drives to the basket. And then in the second half, DePaul put on a run and trailed 59-55 at one point. They were down by four. They had a golden opportunity. They had quieted this Hinkle Fieldhouse crowd. And then Butler steadied, came back, and will breathe easy going in. Could be a 10-point game, but the missed free throws, missed threes.
You know, DePaul, as much as they fought and as hard as they fought, they just ran into a team that's a little bit more experienced, a lot more veterans on the ball club, and Butler was able to close.
Joe Hannell has been coming in and out. And the free throw is good. So DePaul making substitutions. 24 for Dunham, 18 for Jones, 16 for Kravis. The leading scorers for Butler. Crockett, who fouled out, 14 points leading DePaul. DePaul will drop to 12-13 on the year, 6-6 in the Big East. These teams will meet again on February 28th in Rosemont. Kalen Martin. Jones. And Jones scoops it up. 20 points for Jones, the second leading scorer. And that'll do it. Butler wins his fifth straight game. And right now, the big challenger is the three-point basket by Henry. And that'll do it. And DePaul is beaten by Butler, 83-73. Stay tuned for the Jockey Club Racing Tour coming up next on Fox Sports 1. We're on Thompson.
The atmosphere at historic Santa